Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for joining us on yet another joint clinical meeting organized by the Sri Lanka Medical Association. This time, we will be doing it in collaboration with the Faculty of Medical Sciences, University of Sri Jayawardenepura. The joint clinical meeting is one of the events of the Sri Lanka Medical Association done in fostering continuous medical education among the medical fraternity. And without much ado, I would like to invite the Dean of the Faculty of Medical Sciences, Professor Aloka Pathirana, to welcome you and to speak a few words on behalf of the faculty.
Thank you, Shehan. I hope you can hear me.
Yes, sir.
Shehan,
yes.
Am I audible?
Yes,
okay.
Sir.
So I wish to first of all thank the Sri Lanka Medical Association for initiating this program, which has been going on for some time. These joint meetings with different organizations, different clinical associations, and universities. So I think it's a very important and a useful program, which was started long time ago. I can remember. Even I was one of the joint assistant secretaries about, I think maybe about 20 years ago, and I was entrusted with this task of organizing meetings with clinical societies with the team of SLM. One of the main advantages I see with these joint programs is it gives an opportunity for local academics or local people to showcase their talents or activities or their advancements to the others. So it gives an opportunity for a lot of young people to come up with their presentations, giving them an opportunity to do that. So even today, I can see a star-studded panel of academics from our university, and I'm very impressed to see them. Some of them are students, and I'm sure they will do a good job. And I'm unfortunately unable to continue to stay this meeting because I have some interviews starting in a little while. So I wish you all the best, and thank you once again, the Sri Lanka Medical Association, for continuing with this program and inviting us to join with you all. And all the best to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Now I would like to invite the president of the Sri Lanka Medical Association, Dr. Padma Gunaratna, to speak a few words before we start the meeting proper.
Professor Aloka Pathirana, Dean, Faculty of Medicine, the Faculty of Medical Sciences, University of Sri Jayawardenepura. All other academics who have joined from the Faculty of Medical Sciences, University of Sri Jayawardenepura, and all registrants for this program, good morning to all of you. At the outset, let me thank the Faculty of Medical Sciences, University of Sri Jayawardenepura, for consenting and for liaising with the SLMA joint clinical meeting that we have been organizing for many years, as it was mentioned by Dean previously. The achievements or the benefits of this program in two ways. I mean, more than it would communicate definitely up to date the subject material for registrants, but at the same time, it would be an important meeting for Sri Lanka Medical Association, as it brings the outstation clinical fora to work closely together with the Sri Lanka Medical Association. So it brings us together, it appears for academic contents, but it's beyond that we liaising each other itself is a pleasure. So in that sense, I'm again thankful to Teachers Association or the Teachers Forum for organizing on behalf of the Sri Lanka Medical Association this joint clinical meeting. personally, this work from the Sri Lanka Medical Association has been entrusted to Dr. Shehan Silva, who had been working tirelessly for the SLMA as well as for Sri Lanka Association of Geriatric Medicine. So I'm very grateful to Shehan for organizing this. And we generally, I mean, we miss in this year because owing to COVID, generally we get the opportunity along with the joint clinical meetings to travel right around the country, but the COVID prevented we traveling. So that it became necessary for us to have these programs online on virtual platform. So despite that, I see that there has been a very interesting and interesting academic program that has been organized so that I'm certain that this would be a useful venture. So let me again thank all who joined for this program and wish all the best for the program. Thank you.
So without much ado, we move on to the first talk for the day. And we have a talk on pediatrics and therapeutics. This will be delivered by Dr. Shamini Adhikaram, who is a specialist pediatrician and a senior lecturer in pharmacology of the University of Sri Jayawardenepura. And her talk will be on macrolides in children, judicious use.
I would like to thank Sri Lanka Medical Association for giving me the opportunity to talk about macrolides use in children. So the reason I selected this topic is, despite current recommendations that beta-lactam antibiotics should be the first choice in treating children with lower respiratory tract infections, there is widespread use of macrolides, giving rise to resistance, especially by Streptococcus pneumoniae as well as by Mycoplasma pneumoniae. Clinical trials have not yet proven any benefit of using macrolides over beta-lactam antibiotics in the treatment of acute lower respiratory tract infections in children. The next point I would like to highlight is the emerging evidence of immunomodulatory properties, antiviral and anti-inflammatory properties of macrolides, which will change the clinical uses in the future. So I will be touching on the mechanisms of action, pharmacokinetics, clinical uses, adverse effects, and drug interactions of macrolides. If we move on to the history, it was derived from a natural compound produced by gram-positive streptomyces species, which is a soil bacteria. Erythromycin was the first one to be discovered in 1952, followed by clarithromycin and azithromycin. There was rapid increase in the development of resistance, which led to further investigations and the development of third generation macrolides. Examples are solithromycin and telithromycin, etc. They retain the activity against most resistant strains. So what is the mode of action? The antibacterial effect is mainly by inhibiting the protein synthesis by binding to the 50S subunit of the bacterial ribosome. Thereby, they inhibit the bacterial growth, so it's a bacteriostatic antibiotic mainly. And I mentioned before, there is emerging evidence about antiviral properties and immunomodulatory properties as well. Mainly, the antiviral effect is by downregulating the viral receptors and by inhibiting virus production. So few examples are the intercellular adhesion molecule 1, which is the receptor for entry by human rhinovirus, is downregulated. Activated Rho A protein, the receptor for respiratory syncytial virus protein, is downregulated, and also it inhibits influenza A virus production. Immunomodulatory properties are also there. The mechanisms by which it exerts the immunomodulatory properties are complex, so I'm not going into detail in this lecture. And we all know that there is a prokinetic effect as well. Motilin produced by our body is responsible for the migrating motor complex activity in the gastrointestinal tract. So it leads to gastrointestinal contractions. Erythromycin is shown to have a high affinity for this motilin receptor. There's considerable evidence that direct activation of the motilin receptors may affect the motor effects of the gastrointestinal tract. And it is also shown in animal experiments that both preganglionic and postganglionic cholinergic neural pathways can be involved in erythromycin-induced intestinal contractions. These are the modes of actions, and now we will move on to pharmacokinetics. We all know that it's rapidly absorbed and tolerated orally. However, these macrolides are unstable in acidic environment, so the bioavailability depends on the acidic stability. Erythromycin will have a bioavailability around 25 to 30%. Clarithromycin has about 50 to 60% of bioavailability, and azithromycin has about 30 to 40% bioavailability when given orally. Large amounts are excreted in the bile, and only 5% is excreted in the urine. And they get distributed widely in the body after oral administration, except to the brain and the cerebrospinal fluid. If we compare the half-lives, clarithromycin has a longer half-life compared to erythromycin, allowing us to dose it twice a day compared to erythromycin. And azithromycin has a unique property that it penetrates into the tissue, so the tissue concentration exceeds the serum concentration. After that, it gets slowly released into the circulation, increasing the elimination half-life for about 3 days. So it allows us to permit once a day dosing as well as to reduce the duration of the course of treatment. So this is why azithromycin is more popular among treating clinicians. What is the antibiotic coverage? This covers most of the gram-positive bacteria as well as some gram-negative bacteria. And several bacteria are responsible for intracellular infection, such as Mycoplasma, Chlamydia, Legionella, and numerous Mycobacterium species. So clinical uses, this is the most important aspect. It is widely being used in the treatment of acute lower respiratory tract infections in children as well. However, there are meta-analyses, including 24 randomized controlled trials, comparing beta-lactams versus clarithromycin, and they have not found any difference in the clinical cure or recurrence in children. So I'm highlighting that beta-lactams should be the first choice due to emergence of resistance, and macrolides should be reserved for those who are allergic to beta-lactam antibiotics. Widespread use increases the resistance. And then there is a place of treating chronic lung disease. Azithromycin given 3 times a week improves the lung function in children with chronic lung diseases, and it reduces the infective exacerbations. There is a meta-analysis of clinical trials comparing azithromycin to placebo in patients with cystic fibrosis, and it has shown that there is improvement in the post-expiratory volume in the first minute those who were given azithromycin, and it also has increased the odds of being free of pulmonary exacerbations. However, macrolides can be used as first-line drugs in the treatment of neonatal infections with Chlamydia trachomatis, pertussis, Campylobacter enteritis, Legionnaires' disease, and in the treatment and also in the prophylaxis of Mycobacterium avium complex disease. What is, now we have covered the infections part, what is the prokinetic effect? What is the place for the prokinetic effect? Conflicting evidence is still there to recommend recommend the use of macrolides routinely as a prokinetic. However, there are animal and human studies showing that there is a prokinetic effect on the gastrointestinal tract, as I mentioned, in the mechanisms of action. It had been investigated that erythromycin will have a prokinetic effect in infants with dysmotility associated with prematurity and in low birth weight children recovering from abdominal surgery and in older children with a variety of gastrointestinal disorders. So most of the studies have shown that there is a beneficial effect. However, the evidence is not adequate to recommend routine use. So we know that premature babies have a risk of gut immaturity, feeding intolerance, and the need of parenteral nutrition in the long-term basis. And premature babies and term infants, there have been shown reduced cyclical fluctuations of the motilin produced in the body is there, which may be the reason for the absent or sparse migrating motor complex in the gut. So pediatric studies are there investigating the use of erythromycin as a prokinetic agent. They have shown that repetitive non-propagated antral contractions can be induced in neonates who are less than 32 weeks of gestation, and the migrating motor complex activity can be induced after 32 weeks of gestation with the use of erythromycin. So this is a slide demonstrating various studies done to investigate the effectiveness of erythromycin in establishing the feeding tolerance in premature babies. They have used various doses and the maturity of the babies are different here. So what is the place of macrolides in respiratory viral infection? Here also the evidence is not good enough to recommend routine use of macrolides as antivirals. However, we know in respiratory viral infections, the severity of the infection depends on the cytokine storm. And macrolides have anti-inflammatory and immunomodulatory properties, which may downregulate the inflammatory cascade and attenuate excessive cytokine production, which can be beneficial in reducing virus-related exacerbations. What is the evidence of macrolides and COVID-19? Well-documented immunomodulatory properties are there which may affect the disease course of COVID-19 and even before COVID-19. The antiviral and anti-inflammatory effects of azithromycin was demonstrated in viral pneumonias and acute respiratory distress syndrome. What are the mechanisms that affect the SARS-CoV-2 by azithromycin? Few theories are there. One thing is the lysosomotropic activity, where azithromycin accumulates within the lysosome, increasing its pH. So this leads to the disruption of the lysosome membrane. And SARS-CoV-2 depends on the intact lysosomes. The second is by inducing the accumulation of cholesterol, neutral lipids, and phospholipids in the lysosome, leading to dysfunctional lysosome. Again, it affects SARS-CoV-2. And inhibiting the lysosome protease, the key mediator of the replication of SARS-CoV-2. And it also blocks the interaction points between SARS-CoV-2 and angiotensin converting enzyme 2 receptor, which is a functional receptor, allowing the entry of SARS-CoV-2 into host cells. So there was a randomized controlled trial in Egypt. This was not done involving children, but this was done involving adults. There were three arms. Azithromycin was given for 107 patients and clarithromycin was given for 99 patients, and the control group received standard care only. The results showed that early improvement of fever, dyspnea, and cough was there in the treatment groups, and the PCR became negative early in the treatment group. However, this is not done in children. So macrolides should be administered with caution in patients with COVID-19. We all know that there is an association with myocardial injury with COVID-19, and giving macrolides may add to the cardiac insult. So current evidence doesn't support the routine use. Resistance to macrolide. I was talking about the resistance to macrolide time to time in my lecture. So there were several mechanisms. One thing is by reducing the permeability of the macrolide in the cell membrane and active efflux of the antibiotic by the bacteria. The second mechanism is by producing the esterases that can hydrolyze the macrolide. Third is by modification of the ribosomal binding site. So efflux and methylation production are the most common reasons. Prolonged courses increases resistance. So we should bear in mind, if we use it in long-term basis, especially for patients with chronic lung diseases, it's important to have interruptions in the treatment. And cross-resistance is complete between erythromycin and other macrolides. So if someone is resistant to erythromycin, we should be cautious if we are changing it to clarithromycin or azithromycin. However, the third generation, newer macrolides, retains its activity against most resistant strains. Safety profile. Generally, it's well tolerated. Most of the adverse effects are gastrointestinal disturbances like nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, And if we compare azithromycin and clarithromycin, there's less lower incidence of gastrointestinal disturbances over erythromycin. Third generation macrolides, I was mentioning that before, showed a rare but serious adverse effect, which is irreversible hepatotoxicity named ketotic effect. And there is an association with infantile hypertrophic pyloric stenosis for those who received macrolides, especially in the first 2 weeks of life, maybe due to the increased contractions of the gastric antrum stimulated by erythromycin. There can be effects on the potassium channel, leading to prolonged QTC interval and cardiac arrhythmias. However, the risk is less in children. We should bear in mind that we should be cautious when we are prescribing macrolides for children who are at risk of developing prolonged QTC. Parenteral preparations can be associated with thrombophlebitis. And drug interactions. We all know that clarithromycin and erythromycin inhibit cytochrome P450C, increasing the concentration of the drugs that are being metabolized by the same system. Few examples are warfarin, theophylline, methylprednisolone. However, azithromycin does not inactivate cytochrome P450C, so relatively it's free of adverse drug interactions compared to clarithromycin and erythromycin. So this brings to the end of this lecture. The key messages are macrolides act by targeting the protein synthesis in the bacterial ribosome. Usually it covers gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria as well as atypical bacteria. Different macrolides have varying different pharmacokinetic profiles, which should be bear in mind during prescribing. And long-term prophylactic azithromycin can reduce infective exacerbations in chronic lung disease, and also it can improve the lung functions. However, we will be prescribing it on the long-term basis. So we have to review the place of prophylaxis regularly and should avoid continuing it for more than 6 months to avoid resistance. Recent evidence is there that the burdens of respiratory syncytial virus in children with community-acquired pneumonia and other viral causes are increasing, and there is increasing resistance to macrolides among streptococcus pneumonia and mycoplasma pneumonia, and clinical trials have not shown any benefit of using macrolides over beta-lactam antibiotics in the treatment of acute lower respiratory tract infections in children. So the role of macrolide antibiotics in children with community-acquired pneumonia remains unclear, and it should be reserved for patients who are allergic to beta-lactams. Special patient groups can benefit from the treatment of macrolides, and defining this group is a research priority. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Shamini Adhikaran, on this very clear, detailed presentation on macrolides in children, judicious use. I would like to know that is the cost benefit is there a particular reason why the pediatrician or the clinicians tend to use the drug one over the other? Is there a cost benefit of one over the other?
Cost benefit in the sense, madam, as I mentioned, because of the unique property of azithromycin, it allows us to use for a shorter duration and allows us to dose once a day, which is very easy when it comes to children, especially young children. Administration and the compliance is easy, so we tend to give it over the other beta lactams and the other macrolides.
Thank you very much, Shamini. Are there any other questions? It says, can you hear me?
Yes.
It says that they can't hear me. Right. So in the absence of any other questions, I'm just looking to see that whether there would be any other questions posted. All right. Shamini, thank you so much for this excellent presentation. And we'll move on to the next presentation. Our next presentation would be by Dr. Professor Nirmala Vijayakumar. Professor Nirmala is here with me at the NDW Auditorium, Sri Lanka Medical Association. She is a council member. She is an experienced clinician and professor in pharmacology at the Faculty of Medicine, University of Sri Jayawardenepura. She would be talking to us on management of hypertension and update. Over to you, Nirmala.
Thank you very much, madam, for the kind words of introduction and also for inviting me to deliver this lecture at the SLMA regional meeting. So during the next 25 minutes or so, I expect to enlighten you on management of hypertension, which is an update. We need to talk about management of hypertension. We need to update our knowledge. One reason is that it's highly prevalent in our country. The other reason is recommendations regarding management keeps on changing based on evidence. So talking about the prevalence of hypertension, it affects about 1/3 of our population, and the prevalence is higher in the older age groups. The more important thing is that among those with hypertension, a significant proportion, a large proportion, still has uncontrolled hypertension. Therefore, there is definite room for improvement. The recommendations we talk about during this presentation are based on two recent guidelines. One is the International Society of Hypertension guideline published in 2020, and the other one is ESC, ESH guideline, which is published in 2018. Before talking about management, the most important thing is establishing the diagnosis of hypertension correctly. Otherwise, we would commit the patients to lifelong treatment with antihypertensives unnecessarily. So proper diagnosis is important. And if we talk about definition of hypertension, it can be defined based on clinic blood pressure, ambulatory blood pressure monitoring, or home blood pressure monitoring. So we most often go by the clinic blood pressure. The cutoffs are 140 by 90. The important thing is that we need to confirm that the blood pressure is above these cutoffs on repeated measurements. Taking one measurement is inadequate. So if we go by ambulatory blood pressure monitoring, we can use either 24-hour average, daytime average, or nighttime average. Home blood pressure monitoring should be done for a minimum of 3 days, preferably 6 to 7 days, and twice a day measurements are needed, and at each occasion, in the morning, 2 readings, and in the evening, 2 readings, and then over 6 or 7 days, we average all the readings, and if the average is above 135/85, then we can diagnose hypertension. There is this entity called isolated systolic hypertension, which is defined as elevated systolic blood pressure and normal diastolic blood pressure. The hypertension is classified into different grades. This is important when we talk about management because management approach is different. Grade 1 hypertension is defined as systolic blood pressure between 140 to 159 and or diastolic between 90 to 99. And grade 2 hypertension is when systolic blood pressure is equal to or more than 160 and or diastolic is equal to or more than 100. Then there is this category called high normal blood pressure, which is defined by a systolic blood pressure between 130 to 139 and diastolic blood pressure between 85 to 89. The importance of identifying this category is because this category identifies individuals who could benefit from lifestyle interventions and who would receive pharmacological treatment if compelling indications are present. The compelling indications include presence of cardiovascular disease, particularly coronary artery disease. This is not a very strong recommendation in the guidelines. It's a 2B. So we may consider antihypertensive therapy for high normal blood pressure if a patient has coronary artery disease. Regarding diagnosis of hypertension based on clinic blood pressure, there are a few important points. Adhering to the correct technique of blood pressure measurement is important in the busy clinic environment. Whether we do this correctly, we need to think again and correct ourselves if we are not doing it correctly. I do not have time to go into details, but the correct technique, as we have been learning from medical student days, it's important. The repeated measurements are required to confirm the diagnosis of hypertension. This is very important. Usually 2 to 3 clinic visits at 1 to 4 week intervals are needed before diagnosing hypertension. How frequent the visits should be depend on the blood pressure level, initial blood pressure level. At each visit, take 3 measurements with 1 minute between them and calculate the average of the last 2 measurements. The diagnosis might be made on a single visit if blood pressure is equal to or more than 180 by 110, plus there is cardiovascular disease or clear evidence of hypertension-mediated organ damage. So that in that instance, we might diagnose hypertension at a single visit, but we need to take several measurements during that single visit. Alternatives to repeated clinic visits include ambulatory blood pressure monitoring and home blood pressure monitoring. Talking about treatment of hypertension, there are different modalities, including lifestyle interventions, pharmacological interventions, and device-based interventions. Lifestyle interventions, we always talk about them, but whether we put adequate attention to them during our practice is something, again, we need to think strongly. And these lifestyle interventions include stopping smoking, regular aerobic exercises, losing weight, salt restriction, healthy diet, limiting alcohol consumption, and we need to pay attention to binge drinking as well, avoiding it, and lowering stress and reducing exposure to air pollution. The lifestyle interventions are very much important because they alone may be sufficient to delay or prevent the need for drug therapy in patients with grade 1 hypertension. So we can avoid unnecessary drug treatment. Lifestyle changes can also augment the effects of blood pressure lowering drug therapy in patients for whom we have started drugs, reducing the need for more and more drugs. And lifestyle interventions should never delay the initiation of drug therapy in 2 categories of patients, in patients with hypertension-mediated organ damage or patients who are at high level of cardiovascular risk. So that is about lifestyle interventions. Now coming to the pharmacological interventions, when should we start pharmacological interventions for a patient diagnosed with hypertension? So after confirming the hypertension, we need to classify to see whether it, like depending on the blood pressure level, we classify it to grade 1 hypertension or grade 2 hypertension. So if it is grade 2 hypertension, we go for immediate drug treatment. Then among those with grade 1 hypertension also, if there is hypertension-mediated organ damage or if there is high cardiovascular risk, we immediately go for drug treatment. The conditions denoting high cardiovascular risk include presence of cardiovascular disease, diabetes, chronic kidney disease, or estimated cardiovascular risk above the high risk cutoff. So what we use here to estimate cardiovascular risk is WHO ISH risk prediction chart. If the estimated risk is 20% or more based on that tool, then again, it's an indication to go for immediate drug treatment, even with grade 1 hypertension. For the other patients with grade 1 hypertension, for those who are not having high cardiovascular risk or hypertension-mediated organ damage, drug treatment is not recommended immediately. It is needed only if lifestyle interventions fail to control blood pressure after 3 to 6 months of lifestyle interventions. Drug treatment strategy, a stepwise approach is recommended. There are 4 steps recommended in these guidelines. One important point is that we need to always check the drug adherence before moving up in this approach, because the studies we have conducted have shown that poor adherence to drug therapy in hypertensive patients could be as high as 70%. Therefore, we need to always consider that possibility before adding more and more drugs. So this flow diagram illustrates the stepwise approach to pharmacological interventions. for most patients with hypertension, step one treatment is combination therapy. That is a new recommendation. We used to go for monotherapy initially and then gradually add drugs. But now for most patients, combination therapy is recommended from the initial stages. So in the step one, the combination therapies, we call it dual low dose combination. We go for low doses of two drugs. And the combinations recommended include ACE inhibitors, OARB, plus a dihydropyridine calcium channel blocker. Dihydropyridine calcium channel blocker means drugs like amlodipine or nifedipine, slow release. The other combination recommended is ACE inhibitor OARB plus a thiazide or thiazide diuretic. Actually, ESESH guideline recommends either of these two, but ISH guideline prefers the first combination, ACE inhibitor ARB plus a dihydropyridine calcium channel blocker. But there is a there are particular indications where we can consider monotherapy instead of going for dual low dose therapy. So if somebody is diagnosed with grade 1 hypertension with low cardiovascular risk, or if patient is an elderly patient above 8 years of age, or if it is a patient with frailty, we can consider monotherapy because we are concerned about adverse effects of combination therapy. We can use either ACE inhibitor, dihydropyridine calcium channel blocker, or a thiazide or thiazide-like diuretic. So after treating with step one drugs, we review the patient, and if blood pressure is still not controlled, provided the drug adherence is satisfactory, we move to the second step. Second step is dual full dose combination. Same combinations, now we increase to the maximum tolerated therapeutic dose. If blood pressure is still not controlled, we move to the next step. Step three is three drug combination. We give all three, ACE inhibitor ARB, dihydropyridine calcium channel blocker, plus the thiazide or thiazide-like diuretic. So in all these instances, when I mentioned dihydropyridine calcium channel blocker, however, we can use a non-dihydropyridine calcium channel blocker like diltiazem or verapamil if dihydropyridine calcium channel blockers are not available or they are not tolerated. But they are not the preferred group of calcium channel blockers. So after three drug combination, if the blood pressure is still not controlled, we go to the fourth step, that which is four drug combination, that is the three drug combination plus low dose spironolactone. Low dose means 12.5 to 50 milligrams of spironolactone daily. So caution is needed when we use spironolactone because it is known to cause hyperkalemia, which is a frequent adverse effect. We need to keep potassium level monitored if the EGFR is less than 45 or if baseline potassium is above 4.5. Now this stage, step four, means actually resistant hypertension, because resistant hypertension is defined as uncontrolled hypertension despite adequate treatment with three drug combination, including a diuretic, provided patient adherence is good and other concomitant reasons like concomitant medications causing hypertension, stress and poor sleep and alcohol use, high salt intake, these things are excluded. If we can't control blood pressure with three drugs, then that is resistant hypertension. So basically, we need to add low-dose spironolactone when blood pressure becomes resistant hypertension. There are alternatives to spironolactone to treat resistant hypertension. One is that we can go for higher doses of thiazides or thiazide-like diuretics. So usually, if we use hydrochlorothiazide, in up to step three, we use 12.5 starting dose and 25 the maximum dose. But when the hypertension becomes resistant, we can go up to 50 milligrams daily of hydrochlorothiazide. That is what we mean by higher doses of thiazide. But if the resistant hypertension is due to CKD and if EGFR is less than 30, thiazides will not be much effective, in that case, we need to go for a loop diuretic like furosemide. Other alternative drugs to spironolactone for resistant hypertension include amiloride, eplerenone, extended-release alpha blockers like prazosin or doxazosin, and beta blockers. Now, beta blockers are mentioned here as a drug used in step 4. However, there are particular indications where beta blockers become first-line drugs. Starting from step 1, we need to give a beta blocker if patient has these particular conditions mentioned here. These conditions include heart failure, coronary artery disease, atrial fibrillation, pregnant women, and women planning to become pregnant. But you need to remember that if it is heart failure, we cannot use any beta blocker. It needs to be carvedilol, metoprolol, or bisoprolol. If it is a woman who is pregnant or planning to become pregnant, the only beta blocker recommended is labetalol. We cannot go for any other beta blocker. Now, everywhere I mentioned ACE inhibitor or ARB, so you might have a question which one to start. If we talk about the effectiveness with regard to hypertension management, ACE inhibitors and ARBs have shown similar effectiveness on major cardiovascular events and mortality outcomes when we use it as an antihypertensive. When we talk about heart failure management, it is different. ACE inhibitors are superior to ARB, but for management of hypertension, the effectiveness is similar. And it's also found that ARBs are associated with significantly lower treatment discontinuation rates for adverse events. So maybe you can start with the ARB from the beginning. What about antihypertensive treatment in the presence of comorbidity? Yes, okay, thank you. Okay, so we were talking about antihypertensive treatment in the presence of comorbidities, but we were talking about heart failure. For those with heart failure, guideline-directed therapy for heart failure is recommended because the drugs given for heart failure management will reduce the blood pressure as well. So what is this guideline-directed therapy for heart failure? So ACE inhibitor, ARB, or ARNI, angiotensin receptor neprilysing inhibitor, the newer drug, sacubitril-valsartan combination. One of these plus a beta blocker plus a diuretic if there is fluid overload plus or minus spironolactone. So that will reduce the blood pressure as well. Again, I am reminding that the beta blocker should be carvedilol, bisoprolol, or metoprolol. In the presence of chronic kidney disease, we can go for ACE inhibitor plus ARB. Not we can go for, we have to give a ACE inhibitor or ARB. And the second drug could be CCB or diuretic. But remember here, depending on the eGFR, our diuretic differs. If eGFR is more than 30, we go for thiazide or thiazide-like diuretic. If it is less than 30, we have to go for a loop diuretic like furosemide. Regarding post-stroke patients, again, ACE inhibitor ARB must be there. In addition to that, the two options we have are thiazide or thiazide-like diuretic or a calcium channel blocker. But thiazides or thiazide-like diuretics are preferred as the second line because that combination ACE inhibitor plus ARB plus thiazide or thiazide-like diuretic is associated with better outcomes in post-stroke patients. What about antihypertensive treatment in the elderly? Randomized control trials have shown that antihypertensive treatment in old as well as very old, those who are above 8 years even, there is substantial improvement in cardiovascular outcomes with antihypertensive treatment. However, we have particular concerns regarding tolerability in the elderly. One is postural hypotension and falls, and the second one is that they have a higher risk of renal impairment, and the third one is they have a higher risk of electrolyte imbalances. The recommendation is to follow the usual stepwise approach. However, in very old, initiate treatment with monotherapy. And if needed, to go for combinations, the preferred combination is ACE inhibitor plus ARB plus thiazides. Again, because in the elderly, the evidence is for this combination. When combinations are used, we have to start with lowest available dose and very close monitoring for adverse effects like renal impairment and electrolyte imbalances, as well as checking for postural hypotension at each clinic visit is needed. Some important points related to drug therapy. The treatment should be well tolerated, otherwise the adherence will be a problem. When choosing a drug, careful attention should be paid to the cautions and contraindications, which I will mention in a minute. using a once daily regimen which provides 24-hour blood pressure control is the ideal. If possible, always go for that. Use of single pill combinations is preferred. However, in the government sector, most often we do not get single pill combinations. Therefore, we can use free combinations when combination therapy is used. Treatment should be affordable and cost effective, and those with isolated systolic hypertension should receive the same treatment as people with both raised systolic and diastolic blood pressures. I'm sorry if the font is too small, but here I am trying to summarize the contraindications and the conditions where careful administration is needed with regard to each drug class. I will give a few seconds for you to go through it. I'm not planning to repeat what is shown there. Now, we treat the patients because we need to achieve certain targets with treatment. The first objective in every patient is to achieve a blood pressure value below 140 by 90. So after achieving that, then depending on the age and the comorbidities, we go for the optimal blood pressure target for that individual. So in general, in patients without comorbidities, if the age is less than 65, systolic target is between 120 and 129, and diastolic target is less than 80. For those who are above 65, the target is slightly higher. Systolic is between 130 and 139. Diastolic is still same, it's less than 80. When you look at those with diabetes and those with coronary heart disease, the targets are similar to those without any comorbidities. For those who are below 65, we have a lower target. For those who are above 65, we have a higher target. But when we look at chronic kidney disease, irrespective of the age, the recommended target is 130 by 80. It's not a range. It's based on the evidence. They go for a particular target. We need to achieve 130 by 80. Then for those with previous stroke and for those with heart failure, irrespective of the age, we go for a lower target. That is between 120 and 130. These are the current recommendations given in the guidelines I described. This is based on the evidence. One important point I would like to highlight is that this lower the better concept is no longer valid. There is a lower limit for systolic blood pressure. We should not lower the systolic blood pressure below 120 in any patient treated with hypertension. And for certain conditions, there is a lower limit for diastolic blood pressure as well. Device-based interventions include carotid baroreceptor stimulation, renal denervation, and creation of an arteriovenous fistula. These are principally targeted at the treatment of resistant hypertension. And use of device-based therapy is not recommended for the routine treatment of hypertension. Their current place is only in the context of clinical studies and randomized control trials. Until further evidence regarding their safety and efficacy becomes available, that is the situation. I would like to summarize what we discussed during last 25 minutes. Before starting treatment, diagnosis of hypertension needs to be correctly established in most patients that needs multiple measurements on several occasions. Starting drug treatment immediately upon confirmation is recommended for grade 2 hypertension and grade 1 hypertension with high cardiovascular risk or hypertension-mediated organ damage. A stepwise approach is recommended for drug therapy. Adequate attention needs to be paid to drug adherence before moving up. Combination treatment is recommended for most hypertensive patients as initial therapy. Preferred initial combination is a RAS blocker and a calcium channel blocker or a thiazide or thiazide-like diuretic. Beta blockers should be included in the drug regimen in those with special comorbidities like heart failure. According to evidence from RCTs, old and very old patients benefit from antihypertensive therapy. In all patients, first objective is to achieve blood pressure target below 140 by 90. Optimal blood pressure targets depend on the age and comorbidities. And reducing systolic blood pressure to less than 120 is not recommended. Lifestyle interventions are an important treatment modality in all patients with hypertension. Use of device-based therapy is not recommended for the routine treatment of hypertension. Thank you.
Thank you, Nirmala. Thank you very much for that update of that such a common problem of managing high blood pressure. We know that managing high blood pressure is the responsibility of each and every medical professional who is practicing patients. So the I would like to know now, I know that you represent many of these boards that are important with regard to decision making, with regard to selection of drugs for the Ministry of Health. So what is the place for selecting combination of tablets for the Ministry of Health? I mean, we at the moment do not see much of combination tablets. So in fact, it is a problem for patients because these are available in outside. And when they are referred to hospital, invariably they have to change drugs that they are taking.
Yeah, actually we discussed this with the NCT unit of the Ministry of Health as well when we were like developing guidelines for local use. These guidelines will get published soon, but I also think these combination tablets are useful in the long run, because even though the main reason against that is the combination tablets are more costly than what we use now, but in the long run, when the patient adherence improves with the combinations, we might have to use lesser number of drugs. So I think in the long run, making the combination tablets available in the government sector should happen.
Right. Another question is that you did not include the grade 3 hypertension or malignant hypertension that we used to describe previously. Was it because that it's not seen now, as the all patients with high blood pressure are under control?
No, the grade 3 hypertension, the previously categorized grade 3 hypertension is when systolic is more than 180 or diastolic is more than 110. But for long-term management, actually, there is no difference between grade 2 and grade 3 hypertension. That may be the reason why the guidelines do not talk about it. But they talk about hypertensive emergencies and hypertensive urgencies. So actually, when the blood pressure is above 180, 110 in this grade 3 category, it is considered as a grade 3 urgency if there is no associated acute organ damage. Management-wise, still it is outpatient management. The only difference is that we need to see the patients after 2 or 3 days and see, make sure that the blood pressure has come down. But if the blood pressure in this grade 3 level, 180, 110, above that level with acute organ damage, that is called a hypertensive emergency and patient needs immediate admission to the hospital and most likely will need parenteral therapy. So for long-term management, there is no point in differentiating between grade 2 and grade 3 because management is same.
And there's another question that whether there's any benefit using Ibizartan over other ARBs.
As far as I know, there is no difference between different ARBs. So whatever, like we don't have Ibizartan in the government sector, the important thing is like, giving the ARBOACE inhibitor, including it in the drug regimen of all patients with hypertension.
Thank you, Professor Nirmala Vichekon, for that excellent. There's another question with the isolated systolic hypertension. What is the best drug to control blood pressure?
Yeah, even for isolated systolic hypertension, now that's as I have mentioned in the lecture, there is no difference in the approach to treatment. So we go for the same approach with if it is a patient who is not very elderly or frail, or if it is something more than low risk grade 1 hypertension, we go for combination therapy with ARP plus a calcium channel blocker or a thiazide or thiazide like diuretic. There's no difference with regard to approach. That is the important point I would like to say.
Thank you, Professor Nirmala. Thank you for that excellent presentation that covered the all aspects of the management of high blood pressure, which is one of the important, I mean, clinical problem that will be encountered by each and every clinician practicing clinical medicine. So for us to move on to the next presentation, the next presentation is by Dr. Shehan Silva. Dr. Shehan Silva has been an active member of the Sri Lanka Medical Association. He's a council member as well as he is an active member of the Sri Lanka Association of Geriatric Medicine, being the secretary of the association. So I'm thankful to Shehan for organizing, lining up all these excellent speakers for this program. He would be talking to us, a physician, the finest flower of civilization. Over to you, Shehan.
Thank you, madam. Good morning to all of you. It is my privilege to do a presentation for the joint regional clinical meeting of the Sri Lanka Medical Association with our faculty. So my talk is based on this statement, physician, the finest flower of civilization. You can remember your childhood. There was a poet who used to appear in many of your English poetry, R.L. Stevenson. And in one of his novels, he states this comment: "There are men and classes of men that stand above the common herd. Physician, the finest flower of civilization." The melon seller always says that his melons are the sweetest. But here, I, as a physician, I don't confine myself to the word physician just for internal medicine or any kind of medical specialty. But physician here means a doctor, any kind of doctor, just as we are all members of the Sri Lanka Medical Association and the medical fraternity of our country. So a flower can be as sweet as a sweet smelling rose, or it can be pungent like the world's largest flower. Rafflesia is the world's largest flower. Although it is of importance in dimension, it has a putrid smell, which is equated to a decaying corpus. So in the same way, we, the physician, any doctor, the finest flower of civilization, we could be a rose or we could be the pungent rafflesia. So my talk is based on medical ethics, professionalism, codes, and professionalism development. It's essential that we start off by remembering what we are, who we are. Doctors, doctor, the word doctor comes from docere in Latin, which means I teach. Somebody who is able to make an imprint on society, imprint on fellow colleagues as well as juniors and also the general public. We, as physicians, internal medicine people, we consider the Harrison's principles of internal medicine as our Bible. And in the first paragraph of that book, it says, no greater opportunity, responsibility, or obligation. So we have been given the chance, we have been entrusted upon the responsibility, and we have to show an obligation as a human being to become a physician. So that is our calling. So who is a patient? The word patients come from patience, or I do suffer. So the same book in the same paragraph says the patient is no more than a mere collection of symptoms, signs, disordered functions, damaged organs, and disturbed emotions. These are all the things that we learn in our medical schools and what we learn as in our postgraduate life and in the rest of our continued medical education and our practice. But do we remember that the patient is a human, just like one of us? He's fearful, hopeful, he's seeking relief, he's seeking help, and he needs to be reassured. Let's pause for a moment. So in the Bible, there's a verse, it says, they that are whole have no need for the physician, but they that are sick. So it is our duty to think about what we have to do for our patients. High quality of medical service, they come by choice to us in search of this. Are we maintaining their privacy and confidentiality? Are we giving them information, providing them education? Or are we just only curing, trying to cure them? Are we giving time to decide the autonomy? And most importantly, are we giving dignity as treatment as for a human being? So we talk of our rights as doctors, we talk of our rights as citizens, but do we think about the rights of patients? So there was a declaration by the WHO on promotion of patients' rights, and these are five elements which are important that we need to think. So the GMC UK in the Good Medical Practice consensus says essential elements of good standards include professional competence, maintaining good relationships, and having professional ethical obligations. So what are these obligations and interactions? So the patient has a threefold, the physician, sorry, has a threefold interaction in carrying out his duties. It is to the patient, primarily. It is between us, our fellow physicians. Are we thinking about that? And it is about the public. So the three P's, the patient, the fellow physicians, and the public, that is the society and health system. William Osler is considered as the Hippocrates of modern day medicine. And this is what he said. It is an art. The practice of medicine is an art, but most of the time we think about it as a trade. It is a calling, but we think about it as a business. And he goes beyond that, and he says this art and calling is needed in our hearts and needs to be exercised equally in our head as well. So it's a mind and matter combination. So morality and ethics, these are terms that we hear often, but we take for granted. So these are not laws, but they are standards of conduct defining honorable behavior. So we are not bound by the law of the country to maintain these morality and ethics. It's up to us to practice, but it is important that we become more human and more professional by getting ourselves into the reins of morality and ethics. So morality is the belief of what is right and wrong, sticking to what is good or not. It's all or none phenomenon. Ethics is choosing between the right action when doing the opposite may cause harm or wrong. So in ethics, there is no medical ethics, there is no right or wrong answer, but there is always a continuum. We'll talk about that in a moment. So I just recap this, what we know from our days in the medical school. The medical ethics, the pillars, these are what they are. So important thing is not doing harm first. Primum non nocere, as said by Hippocrates, maintaining on the sanctity of life, and which gives the less chances of us doing enthusiastically something that would cause harm to the patient. Beneficence, you may think that may be opposite, but it is actually a reflection of non-maleficence. It is doing good for the patient. What is good for the patient is essential in the best interests of the patient, balancing benefits and risks, and protecting and defending the rights of others, the rights of the patients, as we discussed. So it's essential that beneficence and non-maleficence is also looked along with autonomy, which is the third pillar, which gives the patient the right to choose or refuse treatment, whether it is a bizarre or very unwise decision, as long as the patient can make a proper decision with good capacity, mental capacity, and competence. So that is about autonomy. And fourthly, justice. Justice as in distributing all opportunities in an equal way, more than equally, in an equitable way. who needs it more is that person is that person being deprived of that requirement? So we need to think about that equity, doing greater good for the society. Other than these four pillars, there are two other pillars, small buttresses, I would say. It's the veracity, about telling truth. That's also called as duty of candor, being open, being frank, and also maintaining dignity. We come again to that word, dignity, as a human. So all these are important. So as I said, medical ethics, there's no right or wrong answer, but it has a double effect. Sometimes there will be conflict, but it has to be always decided upon by the situation. Medically, what is right may not be the patient's preference. For instance, we don't see it so often in our country, Jehovah's Witnesses and blood transfusions. Maybe in the past, giving porcine injections of insulin with somebody who has a faith which restricts them from being in touch with pigs. So we might say, okay, this is for your good, this is for your this is for your benefit, but are we thinking about patient's preference? Patient's preference versus a proxy decision maker. So somebody who is, let's say, 16 or 17, a minor, coming to us with some decision making, but having conflict with the legal guardians, the parents. So again, there we need to think about the assent, the capacity of the minor to make decisions. So it's a case-by-case decision making. What is best for the patient? Is it best for the society? So legal commitments, notification. We know that with COVID-19, there was such a lot of loss of confidentiality, which can be arguable that it would have been done in a ethical way. But then again, certain information needed to be disclosed to the public authorities, the health authorities. Even consider the disease which has been there from time immemorial, tuberculosis. We need to notify, but sometimes the confidentiality may have to be breached. It may be a legal reason. So blockade, sometimes because of certain restrictions, let's say in the private sector or in the government sector, if some investigation or diagnostic or therapeutic process needs external funds, it might not give the opportunity for justice, distributive justice. Priority setting, where critical care, especially a critical care opportunity, has to be prioritized for somebody who would benefit better. A healthy young patient versus an older adult with comorbidities. Of course, we have to be mindful of the possibility of the evil of ageism encroaching upon that. So be careful, but we need to consider that in a very open mind and ethical way. Conflict resolutions, differing views of different teams. Maybe the surgeon is telling something, the physicians are saying something, the microbiologist may be saying something. So that's where all have to sit down and do a multidisciplinary, multi-sectorial meeting to may come into conflicts. It may even go beyond the medical professional. It may go to even the carers or even to other parties, maybe or agents in law as well. So it needs to be managed in a very decisive way. So there are red flags in a wigwam. So wigwam is a mnemonic for to avoid skating or ethical issues. Are we concerning about the patient's wishes and preferences? Are we looking at issues of confidentiality and disclosure? What would happen if somebody is disclosed of having illness like HIV, but the partner is being unaware. The goals of CARES. So are we setting these goals with the patient, in discussion with the patient and his caretakers? The patient wants to do certain things like discharge himself against advice. Is he informed or is he competent? There may be other wants. So are we entertaining these wants? Are there arguments among the relatives, the caretakers, the fractions, which will hamper the decisions that we make? So are we able to listen to all sides and come to a convincing decision? Or are there monetary problems like cost of care or earnings? Coming back to profession, the word profession comes from profiteri, which again is a Latin word. It says, I declare publicly. So medicine one is one of the oldest professions, law and theology being the other two. So, and there are multiple now. And according to what a profession is as defined, so we have the ability to acquire and apply a huge body of knowledge and technical skills through education, examination, and apprenticeship, our internship, or even postgraduate training. And we are all shared and bound together in shared commitments like a code of ethics, Hippocrates code, and other codes. And we are bound by a shared commitment to serve the society. That's where we stand. And the third thing is we have a ability to self-regulate. The medical council, which is a regulatory body, which can say, okay, you are entitled to practice, you are not entitled to practice, you need to be disciplined. And we have the regulatory body has the ability to decide who to get into the field and who and not. That is where minimal education standards come. So we have some sort of monopoly. So we have all these benefits. But benefits, privileges, entails obligation. So you would see that we have a huge elephant on top of our backs, but we tend to forget. So our profession is to preserve lives, to heal, and to cure disease, to prevent suffering. So we would do the right healing by informed scientific and clinical evidence, and also by good actions, our morality, in concern of patients' values and preferences. So we stand in front of the temple of professionalism. So how do we approach this? We go on with our clinical competence in knowledge and skills, which is the principles and practice of medicine. We learn to communicate with ourselves and our colleagues and our patients. It's important that we need to know that we need to communicate with ourselves as well. Then we go on to think about our ethical and legal understanding in consideration of humanistic roles and cultural competence. And professionalism stands on these foundations, supported by four pillars of support, that is excellence in our service, respect or dignity, as we discussed before, integrity, being open, being frank, being able to say what we are doing is open. Altruism, doing good for the society. So we judge ourselves by our motives, whereas others judge us by our behavior. So you'd see that there are people like Carlo Ubani, who tirelessly served in the SARS epidemic, even sacrificing his life by living in a community of SARS patients. This was a person who first detected this epidemic coming in the early part of this millennium. Then also Dr. Salk, who developed the polio vaccine, he didn't get a patent for this vaccine. And you see that now polio is eradicated in the world. So from those who are angels, we go on to demons, just like shipmen, who with an intent of reducing suffering of older patients with frailty, gave injudicious levels of opioids and let them go into euthanasia in the UK. Then later on face charges. the Nuremberg trials, as you know. And on mass media, we come across things like House or ER, a medical drama, where we look upon them and we learn a lot of medicine. Even I have learned a lot of medicine by watching House. But how is that behavior going to make us a better physician or a better doctor? So the society did not choose us, but we did not choose medicine or the society, but the society chose us. So we have a contract based on professionalism, which is on prestige, given on prestige, autonomy, and our own regulation. But the society requires that we become altruistic, regulate well, be trustworthy, open, and address the society. So it is not an inherent right. It is granted by the society. We earn it by meeting the obligations. And if medicine someday fails, continues to fail these obligations, the society might change its status. So our profession is challenged by various things: abuse of power, arrogance, we forget about this, greed of money, greed of position, misinterpretation and giving false information and false documentations, impairment as in being addicted to various substances, alcohol and various other addictions, lack of conscientiousness, having integrity and having our own conflicts of rights. So you see that our profession is under siege, just like this painting. Hippocrates is lured by Eve with an apple, which we see that it looks very lucrative. That is what we get from the society, from what we live. And also you see that the serpent in the medical profession, the caduceus, is also encroaching on Hippocrates. So our profession, within our profession, we can be threatened as well. So there's a dual role in the physician of being a healer and a professional, which gives rise to a phenomenon called physicianship. So all these things, being a caring person with good insight, openness, respecting patients, and having the presence of mind, and being a professional who is autonomous, having regulatory body and responsibility of society, we have an overlap of competence, commitment, confidentiality, trustworthiness, ethical behavior, having responsibility. So from time immemorial, we have various codes of medical ethics in history. And as we know, our father of medicine said that there should be sustained appreciation for limits of medicine and the need to prevent unnecessary harm that can be caused by us. So that's where the Hippocrates Oath stands. Sir Thomas Percival first coined the term medical ethics, which mentioned about this concept. And we see that through time, there are various other codes that have come up. The American Medical Association, the American College of Physicians. And then you see that in UK, the Royal College of Physicians put out a statement called Doctors in Society, Medical Professionalism in Challenging, in a changing world, which is set on values, behaviors, and responsibility. And I dwell on this, which is called Medical Professionalism in the New Millennium, a Physician Charter, which was put out by the American Board of Internal Medicine. So this stands at three principles, what we discussed at the beginning: the welfare, beneficence and non-maleficence, about autonomy and on social justice. And then there are 10 commitments of competence. Competence to lifelong learning, maintaining knowledge and skills, being honest, acknowledging report and analyzing errors, commitment for confidentiality to earn trust and confidence, commitment to having appropriate relationships with patients as well as our fellows, because certain people have vulnerability and dependency, commitment to improve care in collaboration to reduce errors, increase safety and overuse, to improve access, so that justice is distributed well, and then to commitment for scientific knowledge, to set standards, promote research, create knowledge and integrate them, and to manage conflicts of interest, and to have professional relationships. So GMC also put out a thing where when we go to UK, this is the first thing that we have to go through as a video format when we sit and get our registration in the medical council. There are four domains on knowledge, skills, performance, safety, quality, maintaining trust and communication, etc. So in Sri Lanka, there the MC has had put out a thing called guidelines on ethical conduct. How many of us have seen this document? It's a lengthy document, but at least how many of us have known about this? And recently the College of Surgeons also have put out a similar document. But these are guidelines. They are guidelines. They are just only words. All of these, what I have spoken, is just, they are just words if they don't come from the heart and doesn't go to the head. So in 1999, the first batch of medical students came out of the University of Sri Jayawardenepura. And at that time, the Department of Family Medicine with Professor Leela Karnaratna, and I think Professor Antoinette Pereira was also there at that time, who had discussions with the first batch on goals, values, and behaviors. And they came up with this code of conduct for medical students, which I think is the first code of conduct of medical students in this country. So this is what I have from my souvenirs. I am from the 12th batch. There have been 25 batches that have gone, so I'm sort of in the middle of the life of the medical faculty, medicine sciences faculty. So this, I think we have to incorporate more in our students, more in our lives. So professional development is to teach about the performance of tasks that we give in form of knowledge and skills, and then we have to make them go into application of this by processing knowledge. This is gained by experience. But all of that, the outer mental is professionalism, where personal and professional values should be encouraged. So how can we do that? Is it by didactic teaching? I don't think so. Preaching one and practicing another? No, not at all. But I suppose this is the best example, is better than precept. There is a thing called hidden curriculum, which is implicitly learned. Our students, as well as our own colleagues, would learn that. We won't be talking about it, we won't be telling it openly, but they would learn from our behavior. Then it is influenced by informal and hidden curriculum. The place of a role model is essential there. And our students, as well as our colleagues and our seniors, will learn, at least to some extent, on what we reflect on our lives, how, when they respect us and trust us. This is by observation and reflection. I started off with two flowers. I end with another flower, our very own lotus from this region, a symbol of purity of body, mind, and spirit. It rises above the murky waters of attachment and desire. And it is a symbol of detachment, as the water drops easily, slide on petals. So can we become a lotus in our settings? I end with this. I'm glad that I have got this from you, President Madam. I think you have stated this in one of your previous lectures in a different forum. To be a doctor means much more than to dispense pills or to patch up or repair torn flesh and shattered minds. It is to be an intermediary, somebody between man and God. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shehan Silva, for that excellent presentation. And you managed to present it in a most most interesting and the most touching manner that everyone could feel it, and for everyone to the need for everyone to respect ethics in our clinical practice. I think that it's something that has been taken up again and again by Sri Lanka Medical Association by having the ethical forum, the ethical committee, and now since recently, again, it has been reviewed, and then groups with interest in propagating ethics among medical profession is in action, so that I think there is so much way forward for us to move together. There is a comment from Dr.
Antoinette,
yes, saying that this the very first this code of conduct was established in 1993 by Dr. Leela Karunaratne. I think it's an important topic that we address. I'm glad that we included this discussion talk in this forum. Thank you, Shehan, for that excellent presentation. So now is the for the time for us to move on to our next presentation. Our next presenter would be Professor Hasini Bannhacker, who is not anyone new to SLMA as well as to the Faculty of Medical Sciences, University of Sri Jayawardenepura. From our side, she is most useful and a very important figure for the Sri Lanka Medical Association, as she is the editor of the Sri Lanka Medical Association. Hasini's contribution for this year's activities of the Sri Lanka Medical Association is enormous, and I'm so grateful to Hasini for her contribution to the my council and for activities of 2021. She would be talking to us on world's first malaria vaccines. Over to Hasini. Professor Hasini Bannhacker.
Thank you so much, madam. I hope I'm audible and my slides are visible as well.
Yes.
Thank you, madam. Good morning to everyone who has joined online and who are there at the SLMA. Well, first of all, let me thank the president and the council, and especially Dr. Shehan De Silva as well, for giving me this opportunity to make this presentation today. So without wasting much time, I'll get on to the topic per se. So we are talking about malaria vaccine today. Now, one would think, the moment you saw this topic, you would think, why do we need to talk about malaria? And haven't we eliminated it from Sri Lanka? And you must be thinking that it's almost near eradication in the rest of the world. And why are we talking about a vaccine for malaria for that matter, and so on and so forth? There may be various questions that occur in your mind. And hopefully during the presentation, I should be able to answer some of those queries, I guess. Right. So moving on, I'll start with this quote, quoting the World Health Organization Director General, Dr. Tedros, who said this is a historic moment. I quote Dr. Tedros, "The long-awaited malaria vaccine for children is a breakthrough for science, child health, and malaria control," I unquote. So this, in fact, the statement itself show what had been, the time taken to produce malaria vaccine. Now, malaria is a century-old disease. It was first detected in 1880, like so. And we have been, even Sri Lanka has eliminated this disease many few years ago. So, you would think, why have we taken such a long time to, get a vaccine which is effective, and you will understand why as we go along. So first, we will see what the situation in the rest of the world about malaria, since some of you may think that it is not prevalent anymore. Now this, I didn't want to put a very complicated image, just wanted to give you at a glance where we are in terms of malaria in the entire world. Now, I'm happy that we are in the blue side, we have no malaria. So basically we have, I'll tell you, we do have malaria, but that is not indigenous malaria. We have eliminated it. But as you could see that some of these African countries, now they are still in a malarial transmission zone. So which means they're having the problem. This shows the disease burden in Africa, which means now you can see that the malaria kills a huge number of children under 5 from malaria. It's not a simple figure. It is more than 260,000, which is a quite a large number. So that is why this vaccine is so important, because it can prevent these deaths. And it, you can see that the total of total malarial deaths accounts to 409,000. So which means these deaths could be prevented if we had an effective malaria vaccine so far. So this is just to show you the Sri Lankan situation. You can see that we don't have indigenous cases. We only have the imported cases. This is for 2021. Up to now, we have had 16 cases. And we also have had a transfusion-induced case. So moving on, I just wanted to first tell you why we have not been able to produce a malaria vaccine, irrespective of the long, you know, people, scientists have been doing research to detect a suitable vaccine candidate for a long time, since I think 1960s onwards. Starting from a mouse model, they have done it. But then the success story had not been so, it had been ups and downs, trying to find a very suitable and very effective malaria vaccine. Well, one reason is this, that is the immune response to malaria infection. Of course, when somebody is, when somebody is repeatedly exposed to malaria, they get an immunity, but initially it is only to the severe malaria and to prevent death kind of, and later on even for mild clinical manifestations like fever and so on and so forth could be prevented with this immunity. But this total mechanism of immunity, in not only for malaria per se, but for most of the other parasitic infections, it's not fully understood. Of course, for malaria, they think that this is strain-specific immunity which occurs in malaria, and as well as they think that repeated antigenic exposure is needed for the development of immunity in malaria. But why have we, found it so difficult to produce? Now, this malaria vaccine that I'm talking about is the first malaria vaccine that that had been accepted by WHO, and as well as it is the first parasitic vaccine which is for humans. Of course, there are other vaccine candidates for animals, like there are vaccines for tinea to prevent cysticercosis in pigs, and there are other research going on for other vaccines, but there is no parasitic vaccine which is accepted by WHO to be given and approved to be given to humans so far. So this is the first one, that is why this big ha-ho about it. And why haven't we been able to produce a vaccine is because one thing is this immunity response to parasitic infections is quite complex, and we have no clear understanding as to some of the mechanisms behind it. And then, as you are aware, when we produce a vaccine, we need to identify certain, there are various techniques of producing vaccines, mostly for parasitic diseases. They think of, if you take one example, the identifying antigen to target the vaccine, the immune production itself is a difficulty in parasitic infections, because the parasites are complex organisms compared to bacteria. So that is why there had not been a vaccine so far. So moving on to the parasite and the pathogenesis by the parasite, I'm not going to describe the life cycle. I know it's a boring thing for those who are not in this field, but I have to tell you a certain terminology, because some of this terminology will need to understand the rest of the lecture. So that's why I have put this life cycle here. So if I start with what happens in at the time of giving the infection, that is the mode of transmission to humans, is via the female Anopheles mosquito. During the blood meal, injects the species, the parasitic stage called sporozoites. Now, sporozoites will be used during my rest of the presentation a lot. So sporozoites is the infective stage to humans. And then once it is in the human body, it first invades the liver, invades the hepatocytes. So there is a cycle called exoerythrocytic cycle, which happens in the hepatic cycle, which happens in the hepatocytes. And from there, it gets into the red cells. So the parasites invade the red cells. And here, it is the erythrocytic cycle, which is important for causing the signs and symptoms, the clinical manifestation of the patient. So the mosquito, when they take a blood meal from the infected individual, they take up all these erythrocytic stages, of course, but it is the gametocyte stage which will be further propagated and go through this life cycle inside the mosquito. So that bit you have to know to understand the rest of my lecture. So the important thing is sporozoites are the infective stage to humans, and then it gets into the liver, and then it goes through this erythrocytic cycle. And when the mosquito takes the blood meal, it's the gametocytes which will go through this sexual cycle inside the mosquito vector. So moving on to the types of malaria vaccines. Now, before I get on to the topic, the approved one, I thought I should give you a bit of a background and an understanding as to what vaccines are there, what type of vaccines are there to break the life cycle. The idea behind the vaccine is to attack various life cycle stages. So there are pre-erythrocytic vaccines, there are blood stage vaccines, and there are transmission blocking vaccines. Right, so moving on. Now this diagram, which I have quoted, I will give you the reference later. This indicates that the types of malaria vaccine candidates and their targets. So let's start with the first one. I'll start with the anti-infection vaccine. That means, now I told you the mode of transmission to us is via the mosquito vector, and the infective stage is the sporozoites, which I have given here, shown here in this slide. Now, this particular sporozoites, you can use it as it is. The whole sporozoite could be used for the vaccine. Those are called whole sporozoite vaccines. I mean, like you use bacteria, when you use bacteria for vaccines, you either use attenuated ones or you use killed ones. Likewise, here, there are various ways of attenuating this whole sporozoites. It could be genetically attenuated or by irradiation or by a process called chemoprophylaxis, where you are given it to the patient and then later on you give the particular drugs to counteract the clinical infection that can be arise due to the vaccine. Okay, so the anti-infection vaccines could be whole sporocytic vaccines, where you're targeting the using the whole sporocyte, and here it attacks the sporocyte stage, that is the infective stage. So we won't get the infection. But apart from using the whole sporocyte, we can also use this subunit. There are subunit vaccines. In fact, the most successful the the one which was approved by the WHO falls under this subunit vaccines, which we will talk about it later. So this is about blood stage vaccines. Okay. Now, what I didn't say about the anti-infection vaccines is those are the more advanced and the more successful ones so far. And the blood stage vaccines obviously are against the blood stages which cause the clinical infection. Now, in the blood, we have, if you remember the life cycle, which I showed you earlier, there are asexual forms and sexual forms. Those are asexual forms, and the sexual forms are in the mosquito. But there are gametocytes which will be taken up by the mosquito as well. So here the blood stage vaccines could be targeted against the merocytes, that is the asexual forms which are in the entocytes, which actually multiplies and ruptures and, you know, propagate and, you know, it is the one which causes the disease as well as it is the one which runs the life cycle further. So the merocyte stage could be targeted. And apart from that, there are these, now this is the merocyte picture, and there are various proteins, structural proteins in the merocyte. So those could be targeted as the target point for the vaccine. And apart from that, now earlier I talked about immunity to, people can acquire immunity to malaria when they get repeated infections, but that does not actually prevent the placental malarial thing. So because of that, people have thought about producing vaccines to prevent congenital malaria and the mother, targeting the placental site for vaccines as well. So those are blood stage vaccines. Moving on, there are the transmission blocking vaccines. Now, these transmission blocking vaccines actually target either to the gametocyte stage, which actually are in our blood and which are picked up by the mosquitoes, which go through the sexual life cycle once it is inside the mosquito. So either transmission blocking vaccines are targeted against the gametocytes, or they are targeted against the sexual stages. Okay. Right. So now here we are talking about the vaccine which was approved by the WHO, which is technically the scientific name is RTS-ASO1. There's a E also sometimes. And this is the scientific name given for the malaria vaccine. And it is produced by the GSK. So the name, the brand name that they have given is Mosquirix. Okay. So we will talk about this, what this RTS-ASO1 stands for. Now this vaccine, I think I told you earlier, is a pre-erythrocytic vaccine. I was talking about pre-erythrocytic vaccines. So this is a pre-erythrocytic vaccine. Okay. Right. So this is actually a subunit vaccine where they are targeting one of the, I'll have to go back to the slide. Right. So this is a pre-erythrocytic vaccine where it prevents the patient getting the infection. The target here is a protein which is present in the sporozoite. This is in the surface, it's a surface protein. Go back again. Right. So this surface protein has been targeted to produce this vaccine, and the aim is to prevent the transmission of the getting the patient the liver infection and thereby preventing the blood stage parasites occurring and the disease prevention. So this is anti-infection vaccine. This is in the pre-erythrocytic type of vaccine. Okay. So when a person is given, this induce antibodies against this circumsporozoite protein. Let me see. This circumsporozoid protein, which is in the outer covering of the sporozoid. So there is antibody production against this. That is one thing. And this vaccine also has some T cell epitopes so that it provokes some production of cellular immunity, the circumsporozoid specific CD4 immunity as well by this vaccine. Okay. So now I'm trying to explain what this stands for. This RTSS A01 means what it means in real picture. Okay. Right. Okay. So this R stands for, now, so I told you the circumsporozoid protein is a surface protein in the sporozoid, and it has this repeated regions. And this central repeated region has been used in the vaccine as part of it. And the T stands for T cell epitopes. Here, yeah? There are T cell epitopes. Now all these three, along with this hepatitis B surface antigen has been hybrid together. It's like combined together as a fused protein. So it comes as RTS. And then this ASO1 is an adjuvant. Now I told you there are certain issues in production of vaccines for parasitic diseases because we need to identify a good target antigen, and that antigen should be able to produce enough immunogenicity in the host. So certain problems with parasitic infections is that these antigens are not powerful enough. They're not immunogenic enough to produce enough immunity to host. So to get that done, they have used this adjuvant system, ASO1, which is supposed to be the best one that they have found. Of course, they have tried various other adjuvants. This will sort of provoke or enhance the immunogenicity, so that that part has been also added to this vaccine. Okay. So when they produce the vaccine, they have, as you know, they go through all the clinical trial stages. And when WHO recommended the phase 3 clinical trial to this particular company that it produced, they started this phase 3 efficacy and safety trial. Now, you all know phase 3 clinical trials are to test the efficacy and the safety of the vaccine or the drug for that matter. So they did it in 11 sites in 7 African countries, which are shown here. And they enrolled 15,000 odd children for this. And that the enrollment criteria or the category of enrolled patients were the infants between 6 to 12 weeks of age and the children of 5 to 17 months of age. And these children were given 3 doses and they were given a 4th dose as the booster. So this shows the kind of results that they got. And as you could see, now this line, the second line that I have given an arrow, it shows the vaccine efficacy against clinical malaria after 4 doses. Now if you take this age group here, 6 to 12 age group, there had been nearly 26% immunogenicity efficacy in this vaccine. And if you take this 5 to 17 months of age category, there had been 36% of immunogenicity in the older age group. Okay. If you look at the efficacy against the severe malaria, you could see that the younger age group has not done so well in terms of the percentage, whereas the adult, the older age group of children has had 32% odd efficacy again with the 4th dose. Okay, so you can see in comparison how it has jumped from the 3rd dose to 4th dose. So basically, in a nutshell, it has, you know, created greater immunogenicity in older children versus infants, and also the efficacy is kind of modest. As you could see, it's not very high, but it is it is considered as a significant public health benefit, considering the damages, the number of deaths that malaria causes in children, as I showed you earlier in my previous slides. So some of the conclusions from their vaccine phase 3 clinical trial. Now they say with 4 doses, they could prevent 1,744 clinical malaria cases among the 1,000 children vaccinated. So that, as you know, malaria could occur again and again in the same person. So they could prevent 1,744 clinical cases with the 4 doses. And that is in every 1,000 children vaccinated. Okay. And well, having said that, if you take a country like ours, say, if the prevalence is low, if any country has low prevalence, this the impact of the vaccine is not so. So this vaccine, when I show you the recommendation, it is actually recommended only for the high-risk areas. Okay. So then once the clinical trial, phase 3 clinical trial for safety and efficacy is done, this was, you know, WHO recommended, not for the phase 3, of course, for this only the WHO recommended in 2016, for the manufacturers to go ahead and do a pilot program in 3 selected countries, that is Ghana, Kenya, and Malawi. So they started this process in 2019. As of September 2021, they have given the vaccine to more than 800,000 children. So the aim, the objective of this vaccine pilot program was to learn about the public health value at the real life setting. Now, this is putting the vaccine into the real life context to see how it does in the, how it affects the rest of the other vaccination programs, how it is accepted by the population, and so on and so forth. So this project will go on in these 3 countries until 2023. And so what they have found out in this during this pilot program is they have understood that it is feasible to deliver this vaccine along with the other routine immunization, so they can incorporate the malaria vaccine to the routine immunization as well. And they also have understood that there is a favorable safety profile. Of course, there are side effects, which I will come to later, but of course, the profile compared to most of the other vaccines had been acceptable. And as you all know, now malaria is controlled. There are strong control programs for malaria. There are insecticide impregnated bed nets, and there is prevention of man-vector contact, and there is this reduction of breeding places, and so on and so forth. There are, so there are certain control measures which are very effectively in place, and also there is an effective treatment for malaria for all species. So they have found out there is no negative impact on the vaccine. So like, you know, when now, for example, if you take the COVID vaccine, now when people are vaccinated initially, they started, you know, hanging around everywhere and not wearing masks and all that. So they had the false security feeling with the first vaccine dose of COVID. Now, unlike that, here, when they studied it, there had been no negative impact on other control measures that are in place already. And they also have realized that it reduces significantly deadly severe malaria, that is by 30%, which is quite a good number. And then it is, they have found that it is highly cost effective, because they prevent, you know, by giving this vaccine, of course, with the booster dose, the immunogenicity that created the can prevent a lot of deaths and can prevent a lot of people getting infected. So it is highly cost effective. So whom are we going to give the vaccine? The vaccine, the WHO has recommended, you know, the manufacturer has recommended to give this to children living in areas with modest and moderate to high transmission. Now these, as you know, WHO define various geographical groups as high risk, low risk, and moderate risk for diseases. So this vaccine is targeted and indicated for prevention of Plasmodium falciparum malaria in children living in regions with moderate to high transmission. Okay. So moving on, the schedule, the vaccine schedule, as I said, there are three doses given and the fourth, the booster dose is given later. And the starting age is 5 to 17 months. Generally, these initial three doses had been given in 1 month's duration. And as I said earlier, I think I didn't say, but my picture, initial picture showed you two small bottles. It comes as two bottles. One is the diluent, the other one is the vaccine. Once it is reconstituted, the vaccine dose is 0.5 ml. And it is an intramuscular vaccine, which is given to, preferably given to the deltoid muscle. Right. So what are the adverse effects? Any vaccine, even though how safe they try to produce it, of course, the safety is a major component in vaccine production because these are given to the normal healthy individuals. So to have it an acceptable level or to be accepted by the general public who are very healthy to get a vaccine, it has to be very safe. Of course, every vaccine comes with various side effects. This also causes local pain, swelling, and some kind of low-grade fever. And there had been reported cases of meningitis and cerebral malaria, which they are watching now to see whether it actually, when you do face clinical trials, you find certain things to prove really the association between the vaccine and the side effects. You need to do more surveys with a larger population. That is what is happening right now in the piloting program. So there had been convulsions, febrile convulsions, and other, they have basically, patients have had convulsions, but of course they have resolved without any major sequelae or without any long-term effects to date, because the vaccine is being given now they are being observed. So like the COVID vaccines, certain things we may find later, but as for now, there is no much problems that has occurred by the vaccine. So basically, to produce a vaccine, somebody has to put money. Initially, it had been other organizations. The GSK has started later on for, expediting process and for these trials and all that. Bill Gates Foundation has put money, and of course, it's GSK. Of course, GSK has said they are trying to, when I was talking about the impact, the cost effectiveness, GSK is, has said at least that they are going to go for no profit. Kind of way of doing this vaccine, so that they are going to just to have a 5% margin to generate income for further research on malaria vaccines for further improvements. Otherwise, they're not going to earn profit from this vaccine. So this slide is actually not directly related to this vaccine. But since it is a subunit vaccine, I thought this gives certain advantages. Of course, the latter ones are disadvantages. Now, subunit vaccines are well-established technology. So this vaccine was produced using such a well-established technology. Now, having said that, if you ask me, there are other, when I initially showed you the picture, there were other the vaccines, that I showed you the vaccine candidates, they have used various other technologies, but the subunit vaccine, it is an established technology. So we know about the technology, and so this can be given to people with compromised immune system when it comes to subunit vaccines. And unlike the live vaccines, there is no risk of vaccine triggering the disease. in the subunit vaccine, which is approved one, and it's relatively stable. And well, the disadvantages are that it's relatively complex to manufacture, and the adjuvants and the booster doses should mostly needed. And this one, as I said before, it needs booster. And plus, when you use adjuvants, there can be side effects of adjuvants as well. That also you have to remember. And determining the best candidates for subunit vaccines take time. That's why it took so long to produce an effective vaccine for malaria. So the drawbacks, there are certain drawbacks in any vaccine. There are adverse effects, and then this vaccine, as I showed you, it is less effective for younger children, younger infants, and the efficacy wanes with time, so that boosters are needed. And then the target we have used, you know, they have used this particular circumsporal sites antigen protein, so which means it may be less effective for different strains, it may be. And in summary, so coming to the last bit, this is the world's first malaria vaccine approved by the WHO, and it's a safe, moderately effective vaccine. And this is for prevention of Plasmodium falciparum malaria, which is the deadly one out of the five species of malaria parasites. And this is targeting children living in regions with moderate to high transmission areas in the Africa. So these are my references, and thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you very much, Professor Hassini, for that excellent presentation on vaccination, the world's first malaria vaccine. I think that's as it was highlighted, though it may not be sort of a fairly hot topic for the Sri Lankan community, as malaria is very much eradicated. In world's perspective, it is an important invention, and it shows clearly how the science, the advancement of science, benefit the population majority in the living in other parts of the world as well. So the out of the questions, one that is important for us to find out is that whether there had been any deaths related to vaccines.
They haven't reported any.
Right. If otherwise, all the other things that are important, all aspects in relation to vaccination was highlighted by you. So that, let me thank you for that excellent presentation, Hasni. That was a great contribution for this academic program. Thank you.
Thank you, madam.
To move on to our next presentation, the next presenter is Dr. Sajith Edrisinghe, again, a council member and a member of the forum of the Faculty of Medical Sciences, University of Sri Javadhanapura. Sajit would be talking to us on human anatomy and nanoplastics. Is our future generations under threat? Over to you, Sajit.
Thank you, madam. Thank you for that kind introduction. Good morning, everyone. So basically, today I'll be talking about a new topic. Some of you all must be familiar with this nanoplastics. This is something related to our environment. So at the end of this session, I'm not going to tell you whether we are under threat or not. So I will be presenting all the facts and the scientific data. So at the end of this presentation, you should be able to judge actually the humans are under threat or not. So basically, today I'll be talking on micro scale to the nanoscale plastic material that are found in our environment. Those are man-made disasters from the day one, from the plastic products that came to the world. So I'll be basically talking about this micro scale of 10 to the power minus 6 and about 10 to the power minus 9, the nanoscale plastics. So what are microplastics and the nanoplastics? So any plastic which is less than 5 millimeter in diameter is considered as this microplastics. So for the academic purposes, we divide these plastics into two categories. One is primary microplastics and the other one is the secondary microplastic. So the primary means from the factory level, it comes for the size less than 5 millimeters in range. And the secondary microplastics means the plastic products that are being thrown away by humans without their knowledge and being exposed to the various environmental conditions like sunlight, the UV radiations, the rain, and crushed by the vehicles and everything. So these plastic products that are thrown away to the environment, the plastic bottles, the milk packets, the toffee wrappings, everything will be crushed down to small plastic materials and brought down to the nanoscale and the micro scale. So going into details, a little bit about these primary microplastics, as you all can see, our face wash, as well as the toothpaste, contains these primary microplastic products. These are available in Sri Lankan markets. And these two images, I think you all are very familiar with from the recent marine disaster, Express Pearl. So we also got these primary microplastics. These are the beads that are we using to create the other plastic bottles and the plastic products. And also, whatever the synthetic cloths that we wear during the washing, we release nearly 100,000 to 200,000 fibers, the acrylic fibers, or the synthetic fibers to the environment. Those are also considered as primary plastic fibers. So by 2018, the data given by the Royal Statistical Society, less than 10% of our entire world plastic waste has been recycled. That means nearly 90% of our plastic waste that we are throwing away daily from our household or from the universities or from the institutions are being dumped as filling of the wastelands, as well as part of them were burned. So if you go through the internet, recently the Malaysia and the Indonesia, especially in the Indonesian countries, they have been using this plastic as part of their fuel for their large-scale manufacturing, the food manufacturing ovens. So imagine the threat about the toxins that these people have been consuming for a long time. So what happens when these plastics enters to the environment? So these are fluorescence microscopic images that I have put on this slide. So these are the microscopic animals that who are living in our marine environment. So whatever the plastic material that have been released to the environment will be ultimately washed. This is only one method I'm explaining first. Ultimately, there are few other methods that I will explain later on. So these washed away plastic materials will be coming into the drains, ultimately coming to the river and into the sea. So once they are enters to the sea, these plastic materials, which are shown in the luminous green color parts. So if you can go through these animals, these are small, tiny animals, microscopic fellows. The entire GIT tract is totally filled with these plastic materials. So as you can see, these are the plastic beads that are in their intestine. So what will happen here is these plastic particles will ultimately enter to our food chain. So as humans, we consume the food materials from different stages of the food chain. So the humans are ultimately the bioaccumulating sites of this plastic material. So there is a gradual accumulation of these nanoscale plastic materials in humans. So this is a small example from China showing that different fish living in the lagoon have consumed they have dissected different fish and look into their stomach, intestine, and the gill. And so depending on the fish food pattern, they have the accumulation of the plastic material has been shown. And this is a very alarming research finding that has been published by University of Peradeniya by December 2020. Recently also with this marine disaster exposure, this the salt which are contaminated with plastic, whether they are contaminated or not, was a hot topic in the society. But before this marine disaster happens, in 2020 December, this has been published by University of Peradeniya. It is available on the internet. Anybody can go and have a look. So they have specifically mentioned, irrespective of the brand that you buy in the table salts, all the salt contain, all these brands are contaminated with microplastics. So imagine how much of plastic that we are eating. So somebody can argue, okay, I won't eat fish. I will go ahead with beef, or I'm totally a vegetarian. So even though you are a vegetarian person, ultimately you are using salt for their meals. So definitely we are in eating these plastic materials. So this is another report. It is also available in internet. It shows the microplastic in drinking water is a WHO report to highlight how badly this plastic effect has affected the humans. This is another research to show you, because I'm giving all these evidence for you all to think for my first question, are we under threat? So this is another research finding. They have collected plastic bottle waters from China, Indonesia, India, Thailand, and they have brought some bottles from online method also, and online purchasing also. So they have gone through each and every plastic water bottle. So as you all can see, every water bottle, even in India, in different parts, luckily the Sri Lankan data was not there in this research. Probably the Sri Lankan water is also now contaminated with this microplastic. It is evident there are research findings, but Sri Lankan bottled water, there are no research studies. These are the new areas that we need to think of. So how these particles are entering into our body? Once these particles are either from drinking water or from food, once they enter into our GIT tract, especially these nanoscale particles, these nanoparticles will get stuck between the microvilli of these endothelial cells, and some of them will be phagocytosis inside. There are different methods, the phagocytosis, endocytosis. So as you all can see, different methods are used by the human cells to grab these particles into our human body. So once you grab this plastic material into our human cells, what will happen is ultimately, as shown in this diagram, it will drop into our blood system. Once it is enters to the blood circulation or the portal system, then it will be going to the liver, and then through the liver it will be taken to the heart and then distributed throughout the body. So once these nanoscale particles are entered to the human body, what will happen here is it will be distributed throughout the body. So I will show you all another study that has been done using laboratory rats, because human studies are very, very minimal, because in this nanoscale plastic, the human effects, human studies, pure and simple human studies are a little bit rare. But there are plenty of rodent studies that have been done, because these rodents are the characteristic behavior and the genetic composition is something somewhat equal to humans. That's why they have done a lot of these rodent studies. So this is another study that I want to show you. These studies with the meals, these plastic materials, 20 micrometers and the 5 micrometer plastic materials were given to these rats. With the meals. So once these rats are consumed after some time, what they have done is they have dissected these rats and look into their organs. So as you all can see, these are fluorescence microscopic images. You all can see this luminous green color dots on the slides. So these luminous green color dots represent the plastic material. So imagine So pay attention to this, the top, the liver, the 5 micrometer liver image. So here, when you see this, the image, you can see here clearly a blood vessel filled with red cells. And along with that red cells, you all can clearly see the 5 micrometer plastic material, the luminous green color particles are there in the in that blood vessels. So that means these are brought to different human organs through the blood. So the same thing has happened to the kidney as well as in the intestine. These zebrafish studies are very common. These studies are available in Sri Lanka also, the zebrafish studies. So they have done to see what exactly happens to the human intestine when we ingest the nanoscale particles. So if you pay attention to the number B, the control diagram, it is the normal intestine which intact with the mucosa, the intestinal epithelium and the mucosa is intact. So if you pay attention to these red color arrows, that shows the disrupted epithelium of the intestine. So certain parts of your intestinal epithelium has been damaged. So that is the exact mechanism what is happening in human bodies. So they have conducted these studies to show how badly our intestines are affected by these nanoscale particles. Okay, now I will move on to another method that will lead to entrance of this microplastics or the nanoscale plastics into our human body, that is by the inhalation. So I hope that you all are aware about this, the bottom left-hand corner image, which is a small beam of light is coming through a small narrow opening, and there are small tiny dust-like particles are floating in the air. So, and this is this shows a grain of rice, and these the next to that is the small fibers that are coming out from your synthetic cloths. So just imagine how small they are. You all barely see these particles, and then we are inhaling these particles also into our body. So what will happen is these particles, most of them will be trapped in the upper respiratory tract, in the respiratory epithelium, but the parts that are missed will be coming to the alveoli level. So in the alveoli, it will cross the single layer of respiratory epithelium on the alveoli side, and then again enters the blood. So once they are entered to the blood, the same phenomenon will happen as I have mentioned before. So I will now move on to the alarming research evidence that have been conducted using rodents. So another study has been conducted using pregnant rats, and these rats were given these microplastics or the nanoplastics via inhalation. They were not allowed to eat that, but in the inhalation method, these microplastics or the nanoplastics were inhaled to these pregnant rats. After that, what they have done was, what they have done is now, after that, they have dissected the fetus of the mother rat. So they have taken out the fetus after some time, and they have gone through the fetal specimen. So as you all can see, the liver, lung, the brain, heart, and the kidneys there. And if you pay attention closely to these white color dots on these slides, these are the inhaled microplastics or the nanoplastics by the mother rat. So this is exactly what is happening at the moment while I'm talking also. These microplastics that have been inhaled by the mother has crossed the placenta and then gone to the fetal tissue. So this is, somebody can tell, okay, this is still a rodent experiment, and still there's no evidence to show. But 2020, a research publication is there. The first publication with the human placenta with this microplastics, and they have shown using this Raman microspectroscopy, there are different plastic materials which are inside this placental tissue. So this is human placenta they have taken. So as you all can see, there are different colors and different particles have been found in the human placenta. So now, again, I would like to remind the first question, are we under threat? So now, this is a little bit of a disturbing thing, especially for the people who are using makeup. So again, these plastic materials, nanoscale plastic materials, can enter to the human body via our skin. So the intact skin will not allow these nanoscale particles to come in, but unfortunately the damaged skin or through the sebaceous glands or from the hair follicle openings, these nanoscale particles can enter to our body. So a lot of people are using makeups to cover up their pimples or the acne. So these the foundations or whatever that the makeup contains, the lipsticks, everything contains this nanoscale particles. Okay, I just want to show you the another research evidence to show how this, the size of this nanoparticle, how this is affected the human skin. So these, if you pay attention to the left hand side, these red color ones are representing the nanoparticles. So if you see there's 40 nanometers, 750 nanometers, and 1500 nanometer. So when the particle size is becoming smaller, when it is smaller and smaller, these nanoscale particles are entering into our human body. So as you can see here, in the 40 nanometer particles have entered through the hair follicle lumen, and it has gone into the sebaceous, the glands. So it is very important for us to know when we are applying these cosmetics, especially when you are buying, pay attention whether they are free of plastic materials. So these are the fluorescence images. Just want to show you about what is happening when you apply plastic materials containing cosmetics. Right. Now, this corona word is a little bit familiar these days. I would like to pay attention for these plastic materials, the dark black color. These are electron microscopic images. This dark black color is the nanoscale particle which is in our blood, which has been entered either by inhalation or by skin or by food or water. So once these are entered to our blood, what will happen is the light ash color, the surrounding like a crown-like thing which is around surrounding this the plastic material is the corona formation. So corona is like a crown. So what will happen here is, once you have these nanoplastic particles in your blood, immediately what will happen is you will form a hard corona. This hard corona consists of your albumin and the apolipoproteins, and those are very tightly bound to these nanoscale particles. And this, the important thing is, this hard corona will form as within seconds. Once you have these nanoscale particles in your bloodstream, these particles will form around your nanoscale particles within seconds. So what the soft corona will form after some time, after a few hours. So what is the problem with this corona? So once you have this corona, there will be a lot of changes happen around this corona formation. The one is this, there will be, the proteins will have their conformational changes. The other one is, there will be this nanoscale particle on the surface. The surface will act as a catalyst to promote the oxygen free radical formation. Once you have this oxygen free radical formation, you all know the effects of this unnecessary oxygen free radical formation in a cell or in the blood. There will be multiple effects. The proteins will be changing. If it is happening in the cell, it will damage the the DNA molecule, the cell proteins, everything will be changed because of this oxygen free radical formation. So what will happen to these nanoscale particles once you have this corona formation? So we will be entering, there will be multiple sizes of these nanoscale particles which are entering into our human body. So what will happen is, once you have the corona, the nanoscale particles with corona will come together and form a bigger ones. And also, it will break down also into the fragment, small fragments. So this is a vicious cycle which will happen in our body. So why are we bothered about this corona formation? So this research article was published in 2020 using this perfusion model that has been done using this ex vivo placental perfusion model, which is a gold standard model that we are using for the perfusion studies, to show this the plasma proteins which will eventually facilitate these nanoscale particles to cross the placenta. So I told you previously, once the these plastic particles enters to our human body, it has crossed the placenta and gone to the fetal tissue. So this is one mechanism. Still we are doing research. Still we know only a little bit about this placental transfer. So this is one method, this placenta, this corona formation using the plasma proteins will help to these plastic particles to cross the placenta. So why we are bothered about this plastic materials? So since they are plastic, so anybody can tell, okay, these are plastic, nothing will happen. So the problem is, these plastics are, when you are broken down, when you break these plastic particles into small pieces, what will happen here is, these are like magnets. These plastic materials like to grab whatever the heavy metals or the other carcinogenic material in the environment on top of this plastic material. It will grab all these heavy metals and the carcinogenic materials which are in the environment, as well as, now when you are making plastics at the factory, they add these heavy metals and other chemicals, hydrocarbons and other chemicals, in order to gain some properties, to gain the color, gain the strength, and the heat resistance, everything. So we don't know what sort of plastic that we are ingesting, because we can't see them. So in the environment also, a lot of factories are putting out their dirt into the environment without proper cleaning. So what will happen is, the fuel fume from the vehicles contain lead. So what will happen here is, this in the environment also, they will grab some heavy metals and the carcinogenic materials. So these carcinogenic materials have been already proven to cause cancers. So what will happen is, once these are enters to our body, through the simple diffusion, once these plastic particles come to our tissue, what will happen? From the simple diffusion, these chemicals will be diffused to the surrounding tissue. So once you enter these plastic particles into your blood, what will happen is, in a one particular person, majority will go and lodge in the liver. Another person, the majority of the plastic particles will go and lodge in the lung. Another person, it's in the kidney. Some persons, it will be in the heart. Another person, it will be on the brain. Some person, it will be on the intestine. So lot of different people will present with different cancers with this plastic particle. One person will come up with a bowel cancer, another person will come up with a liver cancer. So that is what will happen when we take on these plastics. So why we are using rodent studies, as I have mentioned before, genetically similarity is there. And not only cancers, these plastic materials can reduce and directly affect the male reproductive system. it is happening in the female reproductive system. Also, there are studies, I have taken the direct screenshots from the studies that they have done using these rodents. So there are sperm abnormalities and sperm motility problems have been detected. So the most problematic thing is these plastic materials are affecting the genes which are related to the glucose and the lipid metabolism. So no wonder these days a lot of people are coming up with fatty livers, and the diabetic concentrations and diabetic people are going up. So this could be one reason. So a lot of research work should be done to find out the direct effects on this. And also there have been proven studies, these plastic materials will increase the lipid droplet accumulations in the liver. So most of you all are aware that a lot of people are having this at least grade 1 fatty liver these days. So how much of plastic that we are eating? So these are because these are assumed studies, because there are problems when we are doing human studies using these plastics, because the ethical issues are there and they are difficult for the calculation, not like they are given a calculated amount to a rodent study. So these are just estimated studies. These are estimated values have been done in different researches, irrespective of the age. As you all can see, it is available on the air and the seafood, the bottled water, the sugar, tap water, alcohol, salt, and even in honey. So as you all can see, these plastic material, irrespective of the age, it has been entered to our body. So in that study, they have gone into bigger details. So what sort of plastic that we are eating? So when they concentrate into different sources, the water or the alcohol or the air, the majority of these plastic particles are fibers that are synthetic cloths that we are wearing. So imagine the synthetic materials, even from one wash, how much of plastic fibers that we are putting out. So there are now these days, the 2020 and 2021, a lot of research work is coming out from these low quality masks that we are wearing, right? So not the proper one, the low quality mask that we are wearing. So those the mask also contain some plastic sheets, the synthetic coverings. So the humans, when you are wearing a low quality mask, the humans are directly inhaling this low quality mask, the plastic fibers directly into our body. So the Newcastle University, Australia, have just roughly estimated that per week, irrespective of your skin color, irrespective of your age, irrespective of your gender, at least one human per 1 week, we are consuming at least 5 grams, or the 5 grams is just the size of your ATM card. Okay, so by 2025, when we are going for the next presidential election, so they have calculated the rough amount. When you catch 3 metric tons of fish from the sea, at least there will be 1 metric ton of plastics in the sea. So this is how we are going to eat in future if we don't realize the threat that we are going through. So these images I just put for you all to realize how badly it was affected, the Sri Lankan waters. So now we have cleaned them. Now the problem comes for the plastic material that have gone to the bottom of the sea, right? Even in the rivers, when you go through the bottom of the river, it has these scenarios are there, the bottles and all these plastic materials. So because of this man-made disaster, a new word, a plastisphere, was introduced in 2013. This plastisphere means there are marine ecosystems are going to live on the man-made disasters. So as you all can see on these goggles and on this golf ball, there are lot of biological ecofields are developing. So these man-made disaster, when you go for the electron microscopic views, there are a lot of bacteria and fungus who are jolly well living on these plastic sphere. Now, the problem here is these are some electron microscopic images. So what will happen is, now these plastic particles are freely floating from one continent to another. So what will happen here is, these plastic particles will be carrying these potentially pathogenic. There have been a few studies conducted in Malaysia. So Vibrio species have been jolly well going from one continent to another. So there have been studies, the marine litter or the food wrapping litter contains, there will be a biofilm on top of that. And on that biofilm, there are bacterias jolly well living on these biofilms who are resistant to different drugs. So I just coming to the end of my presentation, this is a little bit about antimicrobial resistance, just to show you on the marine litter, the food wrappings, food-related marine litter. So see how much of resistance is there for these amoxicillin and the other antibiotics. So the resistance is somewhere around nearly 90 or above 90. So imagine and think about my first questions. Are we under threat? So this method will jolly well spread this antimicrobial resistance from one continent to another. So this is an image that I have taken in Coquilai 2020. If you pay attention to these two bottles on the right-hand side, pay attention to the letters. These bottles are not used in Sri Lanka. These were purely washed to Sri Lankan waters by the waves. And this is the latest outcome of our activities. I just want to highlight this book, The Microplastic Can You, is now under on print. So it will be released. This is the first book from Sri Lanka Medical Association and in collaboration with Central Environmental Authority and NARA, which is totally sponsored. The printing cost will be sponsored by the Ministry of Environment. So it's a collaborative project. It's all in all three languages, which are coming out very soon to educate the general public. These books are written in very simple language for you all to understand the threat. So we know only a little bit, lot to be discovered. It's like we are seeing the tip of the iceberg of this threat. So now we need this reduce, recycle and reuse is the old term, but also we need to think about this another new three things about refuse, rethink and redesign to reduce these plastics. Otherwise, the environment will think and tell you that thank you for all the support given. Thank you very much.
Sorry, thank you very much, Dr. Sajith Edrisinghe, for that excellent presentation. For all of us who are with interest in the environment, this is a major big topic for the when we consider the conservation of the environment for future. So I'm very grateful to Sajith for all the steps that he has taken over this year. And from the SLMA also, that there had been many instances that we were able to highlight and take up this important topic with the public and the mass media. So thank you for that excellent presentation, Sajith.
Thank you, madam.
Right. So our next presentation, this would be the last for the day, and the presentation will be done by a surgeon. He's Dr. Kanchana Vijay Singh, specialist surgeon and senior lecturer in surgery, University of Sri Jayawardenepura. She would be talking to us on evolving trends in the management of breast surgery. Over to you, Kanchana.
Thank you, madam. Right. I hope you all can see my screen now.
Yes.
So thank you very much. I want to thank Sri Lanka Medical Association for giving me this opportunity to give a small talk regarding breast surgery and breast cancer. The reason why I chose this topic, the evolving trends in breast surgery, is because of two main reasons. One is breast cancer is one of the commonest cancers among females in Sri Lanka. So not only as medical professionals, but as a general public, we should all be aware of the important facets in breast cancer and how can we defeat breast cancer. So that is one aspect. And the second one is, if you look at breast surgery, there have been so many changes that have happened with the concepts and beliefs and the practices of breast surgery that I believe at one point, you might get questioned by one of your relations or a friend might ask you what is meant by a wide local excision. She has been offered a lumpectomy or a mastectomy. So you might one day be questioned on this general knowledge aspect. So I thought I'd just touch on these two areas. So how well do we know about breast cancer as medical professionals? Now, as I said, breast cancer is the commonest cancer among females in Sri Lanka. So it's the number one cancer among females. And approximately 4,000 new cases are diagnosed each year. So that's quite a big number. Now, unfortunately, among these 4,000 patients who are diagnosed each year, the majority of the patients present a little late. Whereas now in developed countries, they detect a majority of their patients at a very, very early stage when you can guarantee a nearly 100% cure. So unfortunately, in our population, still patients are presenting a little late. So that is why this is one of the leading causes of cancer-related deaths. If you take the global statistics, if you take 8 females, 1 female is at a risk of developing cancer during her lifetime. So that is quite significant. 1 in 8 is always at risk. So these are some of the patients who have presented to our clinic. Now the commonest presentation in our country is a lump. Now these patients, what has happened is they have stayed at home with the lump for quite some time, for a few months, and have presented at a locally advanced stage. This is an extreme situation, but what I want to show is still in Sri Lanka, patients present late. So lump is the commonest symptom. Apart from that, abnormal nipple discharges, an axillary lump even can be a breast cancer, skin changes, and very rarely a localized breast pain. Now, what I would like you to just look at the picture in the right hand side. If you see, this shows the stages of breast cancer. So we have stages from 0 to 4. And if you look at 0 and 1, the survival rate is almost 100%. Now, this is the target of the Western or the developed countries where they are trying to identify females, which they are doing now actually at present, at these two stages, which is possible, the screening mammograms, and they treat at a very early stage. So very small surgery, hardly any chemotherapy or radiotherapy, and such a good outcome. Now in Sri Lanka, our patients present at stage 2, majority present at stage 2 or 3. Now you can see the survival is gradually dropping. And of course, for these patients, they definitely have to undergo surgery, chemotherapy, and radiotherapy. So extensive treatment and the outcome is also as not as good as 0 and 1. So I think the one thing I would like you all to understand from this picture is the importance of early detection in breast cancer. This is the commonest cancer among females in Sri Lanka. So why not we get together and try to educate people to identify their cancer at a very early stage. So that's one message that I wanted to give. The second one I wanted to discuss is, of course, the main topic for today is the evolving trends in breast surgery. So like in any other surgical specialty, things are always changing with new concepts and scientific evidence. So what are we trying to achieve these days at present? We are trying to see whether actually less is more. Do we need to do extensive morbid surgical procedures, or can we achieve the same oncological clearance and give a good quality of life to the patient with a minimal surgery? And what's the bare minimum we can do and give the same outcome? Or in some patients, can we avoid surgery at all? So these are the buzzwords or the key topics that we are talking about with regards to breast surgery. Now, the importance in the biggest difference between breast surgery and many other specialties is, now, for example, let's say a patient has a gastric cancer and has undergone an extensive surgery. The only thing that the patient will see is the scar in the abdomen. So it is very easy for that patient to move forward in his or her life after the completion of the treatment for the cancer. Whereas in breast surgery, if we mutilate or deform the breast, or we do an entire mastectomy and leave a flat chest, the patient is going to be the first witness every single day when she is taking a wash or seeing herself in the mirror. This is going to remind her that she is a breast cancer patient. And it becomes very difficult to move forward beyond this. So that is why things are, breast surgery has also evolved to see how, while treating the cancer, can we improve the quality of life of the patient? Can we give a better life, right? So to, I think a good starting point for this would be to go a little bit into the history, a little bit. Now, before the 15th century, of course, people thought if a patient developed breast cancer, there was no treatment. Anyway, they will die. So although it was documented, breast cancer was documented before 15th century also, not much treatment was available. And patients had to undergo a painful death just purely because the cancer progressed. And they had the cancer would fungate, cause a wound, and it was a very painful thing for the patients who developed breast cancer. It was after the 15th century that people started, you know, really documenting about breast cancer, seeing how it spread to the axillary lymph nodes, what actually happened, and started scientifically trying to get into a scientific approach in treating breast cancer. And they started breast amputation. Now, during this time, there was minimal anesthesia. So you can imagine a patient with breast cancer had to undergo a breast amputation with minimal anesthesia with very rigid instruments. So it was actually a very gruesome procedure that was done with the interest of curing breast cancer. So that was what was happening in those days. And then one of the biggest landmarks in breast surgery is William Halsted, an American surgeon. Now, he also was going through what was happening in breast cancer, and he noticed the breast cancer goes to the axillary lymph nodes. So he thought, why not we remove the breast, the underlying pec major muscle and the pec minor muscle and all the axillary lymph nodes and try to give a cure to this patient. Now, he was a very, very prominent surgeon, and his concept was well accepted. But if you look, the morbidity to the patient was such a lot, right? So he advocated this surgery, but it was such an aggressive treatment. And also people started to notice after practicing this for several years that this was actually not giving a much improvement in survival also. A patient who was having a breast amputation was having the same outcome. And there was such a morbid procedure that although people were questioning it because he was a prominent surgeon, it was difficult to challenge his surgery until proper clinical trials emerged in the 1970s. Now, this is one of the landmark trials. What they did was they grouped patients into patients who underwent mastectomy and clearance, axillary node clearance, and patients who just underwent the lumpectomy, the cancer lump, the breast cancer only, and the breast was preserved. And after doing the lumpectomy, the patients were given radiotherapy. So they assessed the survival. This is actually a very long-term study. They assessed the survival for 20 years. And what they found out was there was no difference in patients who underwent mastectomy compared to patients who had a lumpectomy with radiotherapy, right? So now lumpectomy was becoming popular. Now, at the same time, there were certain social changes also happening. Now, this is called the Betty Ford effect. She was the first lady in USA during the 1970s. She developed breast cancer. And at the same time, this Margaretha Rockefeller, she was the second lady, the wife of the vice president during almost parallel times, also developed breast cancer. Now, during those days, breast cancer was not spoken out much. It was stigmatized, and the females were shy or embarrassed to come out and tell that they had a lump or a breast cancer. But Betty Ford and Margaretha took this opportunity to declare to the public, look, we had breast cancer and we got treated. Why not you also go and get yourself checked? And this caused a wave of interest, a great public awareness, and females became very interested to go and get themselves checked, and were always seeking medical help for the slightest changes in their breast. So with this BT4 defect, screening mammograms also became prevalent and smaller cancers were getting detected. So while the research was showing that lumpectomy is also good, now we were detecting smaller cancers suitable for lumpectomy. So now all the surgeons now in the 1970s and 80s started practicing this lumpectomy over mastectomy for early breast cancer patients, right? And they coined this because lumpectomy doesn't sound very, very nice. They started calling it breast conservation surgery. So they were giving a good oncological clearance and preserving the breast for the patient. I want to ask your honest opinion. Now, if you look at these patients, all these patients have undergone lumpectomy. What is the key problem? Although we are trying to preserve the breast, at the end of the day, we are giving a deformed breast to the patient. So while doing lumpectomy, the key idea of giving oncological clearance, the surgeons were just preserving the breast, but not correcting the deformity. So in fact, majority of the patients were actually not having an improved quality of life because of these deforms. And you know, the scar pain, the groovings inside were also giving a lot of trouble to the patient. So this again now gave another discussion. So we moved on from mastectomy now to lumpectomy or breast conservation surgery. And now another issue cropped up with this. Among the surgeons, a discussion came out. Is lumpectomy alone good enough? And they realized that this was giving rise to a poor aesthetic outcome. And now they started to discuss how can we then give a good oncological clearance and not deform the breast? How can we make it aesthetically acceptable? Now this gave rise to the term oncoplastic breast surgery, which is what we are currently practicing now. So oncoplastic breast surgery, the aim means so oncological clearance and a bit of a plastic surgery, right? So what we know, the first aim, oncological clearance, remove the entire cancer from the breast, irradiate if there are any more microscopic cancer cells, and let's try to achieve an acceptable cosmetic result with the idea of giving the best quality of life to the patient. So these are some of our patients that I'm showing. So this patient also had an extensive cancer and a small scar, a slight deformity difference is there, but it's quite acceptable for a simple breast conservation surgery. So these are all oncoplastic procedures. So this patient was a young female who had a breast cancer and who has undergone breast surgery, and it is hardly visible. Just to show to you, because you might not believe, I just put this picture. So there is an inframammary line here. An entire breast cancer was removed from this area, and using the patient's own fat, we have created the breast. So this patient, once the treatment is over, can easily get back into her normal life. Similar one, of course, this patient has a scar, but we discussed with the patient the breast shape, everything looks the same, and we have removed an entire cancer in this upper area. So this is what we call now oncoplastic breast surgery. Another common problem, sorry, I want to highlight. So this patient presented with necromastia, another hidden problem in our society. Patients suffer from large breast enlargement. They get severe backache, shoulder grooving. So she had large bilateral breast with a breast cancer. So we took this opportunity to do a reduction surgery and we removed the cancer as well. And all these patients have very good outcomes following cancer treatment. Now we can't offer breast conservation or oncoplastic breast surgery to all patients. In some patients, we have to do mastectomy. There are certain indications where we have to do a complete mastectomy. But we don't want to leave the patient with a flat chest, especially if they are young and they request for a breast reconstruction. We will definitely do a reconstruction. Just want to show you the option so that you would be aware of these things. So we can do implant-based reconstruction. This is one of the youngest patients that we have treated. She was 28 years old when she presented with cancer. Just to show you, this patient had underwent a mastectomy and we put an expander. You can see a slight filling area there. So what we've really done is we put an expand and we gradually expand that area and put an implant later. Or you can use the patient's own fat. So this patient also underwent left side mastectomy, but we have taken her left latissimus dorsi muscle and flap and created a nice breast for her so that she feels normal. So it looks good to her rather than having a flat chest. So the key what we're really looking for today in oncoplastic breast surgery today is preservation. Oncological clearance and preservation of many things. Shall we try to preserve the form, give some sensation to the breast, try to achieve some proper anatomy, keep the nipple in the right place, have some symmetry, right? And avoid ugly scars and to maximize the functional recovery of the patient. So the ultimate goal is once she has had completed her treatment, we don't want this surgery to dormant her or make her have low self-esteem, and we want her to forget it and move forward with her life as a normal human or a normal female. So we don't see patients like this anymore. These were in about 10, 20 years ago. You can see a mastectomy. And of course, the arm has also, you can look at the arm, it is swollen. And this is a direct effect of axillary node clearance. I'm sure you all remember, we studied in axillary node clearance. We do an entire clearance of axillary lymph nodes in patients with breast cancer. Just few more slides to show. Now we don't do that anymore. Now what we do is a sentinel lymph node biopsy in a majority of the patients. So see, it's a very tiny surgery. We only remove a little bit of the tissue. And only if this is positive, we proceed with the axillary lymph node clearance. So we can prevent the occurrence of lymphedema in many patients. So a very, very tiny surgery now we do. So we don't do this axillary node clearance to all patients these days. Right. So if you look at the future, for very, very tiny cancers that are screen detected, now they are looking at no surgery at all. Can we use cryoablation and destroy? These are at the study level, right? So the future, we are looking at giving a more individualized targeted approach, look at their genomic profile, see who will benefit from surgery, because the real target is in the future is to try and get all the patients to identify or detect their cancer at a very, very early stage, right? So that a smaller surgery can be done, or a minimal or no surgery, and only just medication might be, or cryoablation might be enough for these patients. So my take home message for you all is, please understand the importance of early detection of breast cancer. Let's try to spread this message so that we'll educate people, self-breast examination for all females once a month. But if you're above 45, it's always best to get a screening mammogram to see whether you have a preclinical, a small sum cancer cells harboring in your breast. Yes, so thank you very much. I just want to again re-emphasize on self-breast examination and annual mammogram. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kanchana Vijayasinghe, for that short, but then interesting and an important presentation on evolving trends in the management of breast surgery. I think you highlighted only one aspect of it. It's the aesthetic aspect of the breast cancers, which has not been discussed much to the ordinary medical professionals. I think it's important that we all are aware of the advancements of this common, the most common cancer that's available among us, females in this community. I'm so grateful for you, for your spending time and interest on this subject. Thank you for your excellent presentation. I think that brings to an end of the joint clinical meeting organized by the Sri Lanka Medical Association in collaboration with the Faculty of Medical Sciences, University of Sri Jayawardenepura. We all together went through six presentations. The very first was on macrolides in children, the judicious use, where it was highlighted the use of the benefits of azithromycin as a macrolide over others, as well as the need to be a little reserved when using macrolides, in particular in case of children, and for pneumonias when there are other beta antibiotics such as beta-lactam. Then the next presentation was by Professor Nirmala Vijaykoon on management of hypertension, where she highlighted the management guidelines, the non-medical medical and interventions for management of hypertension. And in medical management, the lineup, the set guideline for when deciding on drug treatment for management for grade 1 and grade 2 hypertension, and the need for the dietary and exercise measures and weight reduction and stop smoking and so on prior to commencing the patient on drug treatment. And then the Dr. Shehan Silva address on physician, the finest flower of civilization. When we become doctors, that we have become doctors, not as a choice of people, but as the choice of the medical professionals, so that for us to respect the ethics that are applicable for our profession. And Professor Hassini address on the first malaria vaccine, which was totally new and which is so much a life-saving for many living in this world, though it's not that important for the Sri Lankan. Then the plastics, then the value of the lessons need to be learned, and the hazards that are seen with the nano and micro use of nano and microplastics, so that the threats of microplastics for the future generations was highlighted by our next speaker, Dr. Sajith Edrisinghe. And just finished was Dr. Kanchana Vijayasinghe's presentation on the evolving trends in the management of breast surgery, which again is not very important and the most common cancer seen among females. So I think that all in all, that we have done a wonderful session. I'm very grateful to Dr. Professor Aloka Pathirana for consenting to liaise with the Faculty of Medical Sciences, University of Sri Jayawardenepura, and also Dr. Shehan Silva for organizing this program. And thank you very much for all who remain with us until the end of the program. So that brings to an end. Thank you very much. Stay safe. Mm-hmm.